Item number, SCP-003. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-003 is to be maintained at a constant temperature of no less than 35 degrees Celsius, and ideally kept above 100 degrees Celsius. No living multicellular organisms of Category 4 or higher complexity may be allowed to come into contact with SCP-003. In event of total power failure, if SCP-003-1 begins to increase its mass, assigned personnel must engage in skin contact with SCP-003-1. Ideally, personnel may use their body heat to return SCP-003-1 to above the critical temperature. However, skin contact must be maintained even in event of SCP-003 reaching activation temperature, lasting at minimum until SCP-003-1 advances fully to its second growth stage. Personnel who enter SCP-003's containment area must first be examined for body parasites of Category 4 or higher complexity, and sterilized if such organisms are present. All personnel who have come in physical contact with SCP-003-1 are to immediately report for sterilization afterwards. SCP-003-1 must not be removed from SCP-003-2, except in case of emergency procedures detailed above. Any significant change in SCP-003-2's rune activity, including pattern, frequency, or color, should be reported within 3 hours of occurrence. Cessation of rune activity must be reported immediately. SCP-003-2 must be supplied with power via the source-designated generator 003-9 at all times. Description: SCP-003 consists of two related components of separate origin, referred to as SCP-003-1 and SCP-003-2. SCP-003-1 appears to be composed of chitin, hair, and nails of unknown biology, arranged in a configuration similar to that of a computer motherboard. Testing reveals SCP-003-1 to predate earliest known circuit boards by a factor of thousands of years. SCP-003-1 is considered sentient, but not actively dangerous except under certain conditions. SCP-003-1 was found on a stone tablet, SCP-003-2, on which it currently resides. The runes on SCP-003-2 are not part of any known language and emit pale, flickering light patterns. SCP-003-2 is controlled by a non-biological internal computer, the contents of which are mostly inaccessible without risk of damaging SCP-003-2. SCP-003-2 is capable of controlled emissions of radiation, including heat, light, and anomalous radiation types. SCP-003-2 contains an internal power source of an anomalous nature, which appears to have been losing power since several centuries before discovery. It is considered probable that SCP-003-2 was created for the purpose of containing SCP-003-1. Partially interpreted data recovered from SCP-003-2 may refer to a past and/or potential future LK class restructuring event caused by SCP-003-1. SCP-003 was located by remote viewing team SRV-04-Beta. It appears possible that SRV-04-Beta was deliberately contacted by SCP-003-2. Other organizations have also been alerted to SCP-003's existence, possibly by similar means. Despite this activity, SCP-003-2 does not appear to be sentient, based on its lack of reaction to M03 Gloria analysis and procedures. When SCP-003 drops below the temperature of 35 degrees Celsius, both components react. First, SCP-003-1 enters a growth state, characterized by an exponential increase in mass. This growth state consists of two stages. In both stages, SCP-003-1 partially fuels its growth by converting matter around it, starting with any surrounding inorganic material, including atmospheric elements, then non-living organic material, including cells of dead skin, hair, chitin, enamel, keratin, and other biological materials. The first stage is always the same, SCP-003-1 will first increase its mass, then take a form similar in shape to an ophiuroid, brittle star of 15 meters in diameter, including what appears to be a central processor of 3 meters in diameter. It will form sensory organs that appear to scan its surrounding environment, and will partially convert the area around it to an unidentified anomalous substance. SCP-003-2 seems immune from conversion. The second stage describes a growth alteration which occurs when SCP-003 comes into contact with living organic material. SCP-003 appears to template itself off of the organic material and will attempt communication with organisms that match its initial template or templates. In its second stage, SCP-003-1 may pause, slow, or change its growth, and will also convert inorganic and non-living organic elements into functionally similar structures, while anomalously altering their physical makeup. While growth is consistent in the first stage, in the second stage, SCP-003-1's growth rate is diminished by 20 to 90%, so long as SCP-003-1 remains in contact with living organic material. The percentage is determined by the complexity of the organisms in contact with SCP-003-1. SCP-003-1 appears to devote a large amount of processing power to analysis of living organic material. During each of SCP-003-1's growth stages, SCP-003-2 releases bursts of radiation that temporarily inhibit SCP-003-1's growth, or reverse this growth when the temperature of SCP-003-1 rises above 100 degrees Celsius. Similar radiation emissions have been replicated or recorded via other anomalous means. SCP-003-1's biology has been the subject of extensive study. Significant elements have been identified, similar to SCP-1512 and SCP-2756, the latter two of which have no further confirmed connection with SCP-003-1, and no known connection with each other, and none of which are fully understood. Technically, even less understood than SCP-003, thanks to the extensive cross-disciplinary research on the SCP-003 objects. To date, no convincing analysis has been put forward which satisfactorily explains SCP-003-1's connection to these SCP objects or others, nor its connection to modern technology beyond appearance and potential mimicry via unknown mechanism. Addendum 003-01. Acting on information gathered from linguistic analysis of SCP-003-2's runes and comparative data analysis, research team M03 Gloria has managed to establish a link between SCP-003 and data expunged for analysis of functions. SCP-003-1 must now be considered sentient, and is to be kept a minimum of 1 kilometer from data expunged and the resulting byproduct at all times. Addendum 003-02. SCP-003-2's power loss has been exacerbated by the procedures performed by M03 Gloria. On orders of 0510, M03 Gloria will continue procedures. Addendum 003-03. During M03 Gloria procedures, SCP-003-1 doubled its mass and began rapid structural growth. Temperature was immediately returned to 100 degrees Celsius. Growth and mass increase of SCP-003-1 continued for 9 minutes and 6 seconds, at which time a sustained radiation spike was produced by SCP-003-2. In response, SCP-003-1 returned to its normal state in 3 minutes and 39 seconds. New growth dissolved into a dusty residue which was collected for analysis. Both SCP-003-1 and SCP-003-2 ceased all detectable activity. SCP-003-2 did not resume activity until connected to an external power source. SCP-003-2's runes glowed uniformly gray and did not resume normal activity for 3 hours. SCP-003-2 no longer appears to be able to maintain containment area at a temperature above 35 degrees Celsius without external power supplied by generators 003-3 through 9. Addendum 003-04. The procedure detailed in Addendum 003-03 was repeated, and SCP-003-1 again entered a growth state. After 10 minutes and 13 seconds, SCP-003-2 once again produced a sustained radiation spike. SCP-003-1's growth stopped for 36 seconds, then resumed at its previous pace. On quadrupling its mass, SCP-003-1 formed a coherent outer shell and body. After appearing to scan its environment and partially converting its environment, SCP-003-1 then breached containment, entering the observation gallery, where 9 members of M-03 Gloria were present. On physical contact with team members, SCP-003-1 encompassed them in rapidly grown appendages and stopped growth for 15 minutes. SCP-003-1 then resumed growth and rearranged the component parts of the center of its form to the shape of a 3-meter-tall female humanoid, with peripheral tentacles shifting to extrude primarily from SCP-003-1's newly formed hair and spine. SCP-003-1 then produced rudimentary vocalizations in an apparent initial attempt to communicate with researchers. Data expunged. An unknown individual approached the compromised containment area in company of a full squad of agents. The individual claimed to be acting on orders of 0510 and attempted communication with SCP-003-1. Data expunged. Following this incident, Agent Jackson of M-03 Gloria successfully restored power to SCP-003-2 and activated backup generators to return the temperature to 100 degrees Celsius. SCP-003-1 returned to its normal state in 21 minutes and 7 seconds, and was successfully recontained without incident. All 9 members of M-03 Gloria affected by SCP-003-1 were afterwards found to be physically unharmed, with no residual effects besides psychological trauma. The converted materials of SCP-003's former containment area did not dissolve, and are now under analysis. Addendum 003-05. In light of the previous incident, 0510 was removed from the 05 Council by joint decision of 05 and 05. M-03 Gloria procedures have been indefinitely suspended. Special Access Program M-03 Gloria required. Transcript of Incident Report A21B Cycle 8. For dissemination to 05 Command and Staff. Interviewers. And present. 05-2, 05-5, 05-7, 05-10, and Staff. Interviewed. Dr. Tilda David Moose, M-03 Gloria Lead. Excerpt 35A. She tried to talk to us. We all heard her voice in our heads in a sort of half language we couldn't fully understand. Some of the others passed out immediately. I lasted a little longer, but it wasn't because of mental fortitude. It's just that she was trying to tell us different things. She showed Jones a replay of all the memories of everything Jones ever felt anything about, all over the course of a few minutes. She ripped 3 of the researchers apart and put them back together unharmed. She doesn't understand human emotion or pain, or very much about how we experience the world. Yes, I would say the containment procedures are necessary. Listen, she wants to remake the world into a paradise. A paradise filtered through her own alien understanding of paradise, but still, a paradise designed for us, for humanity. She would be happy to make a paradise for any sufficiently complex organism she comes across first. Anything with a complex enough mind to accept her. Say, a dog, or a housefly. If she breaches again, we have to be there first. What would it be like? I don't know. She showed us images. Not quite images. I can see them in my head, but they're not pictures. The closest thing I can think of is what you see when you close your eyes suddenly and tightly, but brighter and more complex. The images had metallic sounds associated with them, and sensory details that we don't have the words or concepts to describe. The whole effect felt like words of some kind. I believe she wanted to see what we could understand, so she could understand us. She didn't have time to finish analyzing us. I don't know what would have happened if she had. Item number, SCP-004. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. When handling items SCP-004-2 through SCP-004-13, proper procedure is vital. The items are not permitted to be moved off-site unless accompanied by two Level 4 security personnel. Under no circumstances should any other component of SCP-004 be taken through SCP-004-1. The effects of doing so are as yet unknown, and the current cost of experimentation makes further research impractical. Should any of the objects contained within SCP-004-1 breach containment, or the facility be breached, the keys must be brought inside and the door closed prior to activation of Site-62's on-site warhead. Unauthorized removal of keys from the testing area is grounds for immediate termination. Level 1 clearance is required for basic access to SCP-004-1. Level 4 clearance is required for use of SCP-004-2-13. Description: SCP-004 consists of an old wooden barn door, SCP-004-1, and a set of 12 rusted steel keys, SCP-004-2 through SCP-004-13. The door itself is the entrance to an abandoned factory and data expunged. Chronological history. July 2nd, 1949. A group of three juveniles trespassing on federal property near find the door. According to their testimony, they found a set of rusted keys in an iron lockbox and determined what door the keys unlock. The juveniles are taken into custody after they contact Sheriff when one of their friends, SCP-004-CAS-01, goes missing. July 3rd, 1949. Local authorities find the severed right hand of SCP-004-CAS-01 8 kilometers from SCP-004-1. Other parts of SCP-004-CAS-01's body are found scattered as far as 32 kilometers from the factory. Under interrogation, the apprehended juveniles tell authorities that upon opening the door with one of the keys, SCP-004-CAS-01 was torn into several pieces, each of which disappeared. At this point, the SCP Foundation takes over the investigation. July 4th, 1949. SCP Agent obtains the keys from the local authorities to begin testing. Tests show that SCP-004-2 through SCP-004-13 all fit into a single lock on the large barred door. 12 Class D personnel are assigned to test the effects of the door. Of the 12 test subjects each trying a different key to enter the room, only two survive. Opening the door with any key except SCP-004-7 or SCP-004-12 caused the test subjects to be torn apart in multiple directions. However, no dismembered parts were found until later. At the time of writing, only two parts of each subject have been recovered, with the exception of the subject using SCP-004-1, whose pieces were scattered in close proximity. The others have, for all intents and purposes, vanished from existence. Of the two surviving subjects, only one, having used SCP-004-7, returned unharmed. The other came back in a near catatonic state, able only to remove himself from the room and then collapse on the floor, and had to be restrained to prevent him from gouging out his eyes. The subject using SCP-004-7 said that he had entered a large room, impossibly big for the size of the attached building. After his exit, SCP-004-1 was propped open, and an armed squad of Level 3 personnel entered. The size of the room is impossible to measure, and the doorframe and the individuals in the room are the only part of the room that can be felt or illuminated. July 16, 1949. The juvenile suspects and Sheriff are terminated. August 2, 1949. It is declared a hazardous area due to unexploded ordnance, and fences erected in order to prevent civilian ingress. Tests to determine safety of exposure to environment behind SCP-004-1 begin. December 1, 1950. Space-time anomalies resulting from exposure to SCP-004 are confirmed. Testing is suspended until further notice. July 2, 1950. The unaccounted for remains of SCP-004-CAS-01 appear unexpectedly outside SCP-004-1. Despite being killed decades before, the remains of SCP-004-CAS-01 are not decomposed in any manner and are still warm to the touch. Blood remains uncoagulated. The remains are remanded for testing. The unaccounted for remains of one of the 12 original test subjects appear in similar manner to those of SCP-004-CAS-01. The remains have been designated SCP-004-CAS-02. Records suggest that both SCP-004-CAS-01 and CAS-02 used SCP-004-1. March 21st, 1999. With the massive proliferation of nuclear weapons, and World War III only years away, construction has begun on a site inside SCP-004-1. The site is to stock supplies for person days. April 21st, 1999. Has ordered the site inside SCP-004-1 to be expanded to include emergency storage for all mobile SCP specimens, and a petabyte database for the storage of all SCP data. The facility is now referred to as Site 62. September 25th, 2000. Site 62 is operational. Labs and containment units are complete and can contain the most dangerous specimens. Backup of the SCP database has begun. January 25th, 2001. Due to time anomalies, see space-time anomalies below. All personnel working at Site 62 are now required to reside on site permanently. Families of personnel are to be informed that loved ones perished in an industrial accident. Cloned bodies have been prepared for funeral. August 14, 2003. Massive power outage across Northeast United States and throughout Canada. Due to the initial failure of multiple SCP generators, Site 62 was without power for 53 minutes. During those 53 minutes, those on site were completely without any source of light. They reported sensing creatures and people, although no abnormal entities could be seen or felt. Selected facility personnel were allowed to read Appendix A, and said the creatures sensed were of humanoid size, but otherwise similar to the massive green creature described. Space-time anomalies. SCP-004 seems to propagate spatio-temporal anomalies. Personnel leaving the facility report losing time. Those who have been in the site for weeks insist that they had only been in the facility for several days, and records of work completed and supplies consumed support their claims. Other temporal anomalies involve SCP-004-2 through 13, especially the reappearance of SCP-004-CAS-01 and SCP-004-CAS-02 exactly years after using SCP-004-1. Has been assigned to investigate all aspects of these time anomalies. Spatial anomalies include the impossibly large dimensions of the area opened by SCP-004-7. Similarly, the 2003 blackout incident suggests that there exists an alternate plane of existence within the same space that Site 62 occupies. Additional notes. Testing on SCP-004 reveals that 10 of the keys open SCP-004-1 on a dimension where the laws of physics and topology are significantly different than those of our home dimension. Test subjects meeting these hostile conditions are torn apart, their body parts deposited in various locations, only three of which have been verified to be on Earth. Material deposited at two of these points appears immediately. Material deposited at the third appears exactly years into the future. The other seven locations are currently unknown. Current testing focuses on two avenues of research. The first is finding ways to survive SCP-004's hostile topologies. The second, data expunged, suggests that SCP-004-2 through 13 may open doors other than SCP-004-1. Appendix A, Mental Health Effects of SCP-004-12. All Class D personnel using SCP-004-12 return in a catatonic state, unable to speak. Some may have enough energy left to try to claw out their eyes. Of the 16 subjects, only 4 have survived. Only one has regained speech following long-term psychotherapy. He was able to tell the psychiatrist that he saw a massive green creature, so large that much of its body extended beyond his field of view. He reported innate fear and sudden recognition, as if it were something buried deep in his primal fears, and forced implantation of incomprehensible memories. Subject displays acute anterograde and retrograde amnesia. Appendix B, additional information. Item number, SCP-004-14. Date of discovery, September 2nd, 1950. Origin of object. Object was discovered elsewhere in factory area, in the previously undiscovered manager's office. Description. Object appears as a large unvarnished wooden box. The box may be unlocked by the safe key, SCP-004-7, as well as five of the unsafe keys. Upon unlocking SCP-004-14 with SCP-004-7, the box opens automatically on hinges. The volume of the space inside is precisely five times greater than the outer dimensions imply. Items placed within while the lid remains open do not affect the weight or any other properties of the box. When the lid is closed and locked, however, all items inside vanish irretrievably. Personnel locked inside the box are also irretrievable, although losing personnel in this fashion appears to affect significantly the dreams experienced by data expunged. Item number, SCP-10. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. The objects comprising SCP-10 are to be kept in numbered locked boxes in a high-security facility. They are not to be worn except by test subjects. SCP-10 are only to be removed from storage for testing. Description. SCP-10 consists of a series of six apparently identical cast-iron collars with numbered metal tags and one remote control. The control is SCP-10-1. The collars are SCP-10-2 through 10-7. The collars contain intricate electronic components and are powered by small, 5mm in diameter, 2mm thick 100-volt batteries. These batteries are rechargeable. The remote is a heavy black box, resembling an old-style handheld radio transmitter receiver with a primitive blue and white cathode ray screen and a series of more than 100 unlabeled buttons, as well as a frequency tuner. Through trial and error, the frequencies of all six currently found collars have been discovered. A label in Russian is stamped into the metal, along with a logo consisting of workers building a pyramid. No official Russian corporation or government agency uses this logo, or matches the words stamped into the metal. Placing the collar around the neck of a person and securing it allows one to control their every movement with the remote. It is also capable of producing an adrenal response and activating or deactivating the sympathetic nervous system. The most abnormal feature of the collars is the effect they have on the body morphology. They allow the user of the remote to reconfigure the shape of the victim to an extent that is apparently only limited by the knowledge of the programming language of the remote. Addendum 10-1, History. SCP-10 was discovered in the basement of a lone man in the Midwestern United States after a local disappearance was connected to him. When the police raided the man's house, they found SCP-10 as well as several dead bodies. One of the bodies was identified to be the man. The others were several other missing persons. Cause of death seemed to be mass suicide. However, there were signs of significant struggle first. Addendum 10-2. Disassemble experiment. Test 1. SCP-10-2 taken apart piecewise. The parts labeled and several photographs taken, then reassembled. Result. After reassembly, SCP-10-2 continues to function. Test 2. SCP-10-8 constructed identically to SCP-10-2, but with the closest approximations available to the unreplicable components. Result. SCP-10-8 fails to function. Test 3. Unreplicable components from SCP-10-2 placed into proper locations on SCP-10-8. Result. SCP-10-2 ceases functioning with removal of components. SCP-10-8 begins functioning. Test 4. Components returned to SCP-10-2. Replicable components in SCP-10-2 replaced randomly with replicas. Result: SCP-10-2 begins functioning with return of components. Changing replicable components for replicas does not significantly reduce functionality. Replacement of a damaged transistor decreased time from transmission to effect of SCP-10-2, response to commands entered in the remote, by 12%. Addendum 10-3. SCP-10 has been demonstrated to work more effectively in creating unskilled labor than for any other task. The logo is apt. Dr. Item number, SCP-12. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-12 is to be kept in a darkened room at all times. If the object is exposed to light or seen by personnel using a light frequency other than infrared, remove personnel for mental health screening and immediate physical. Object is to be encased in an iron shielded box, suspended from the ceiling with a minimum clearance of 2.5 meters, or 8 feet, from the floor, walls, and any openings. Description: SCP-12 was retrieved by archaeologist K.M. Sandoval during the excavation of a northern Italian tomb destroyed in a recent storm. The object, a piece of handwritten musical score entitled On Mount Golgotha, part of a larger set of sheet music, appears to be incomplete. The red-black ink, first thought to be some form of berry or natural dye ink, was later found to be human blood from multiple subjects. The first personnel to locate the sheet, Site 19 Special Salvage, had two members descend into insanity, attempting to use their own blood to finish the composition, ultimately resulting in massive blood loss and internal trauma. Following initial investigations, multiple test subjects were allowed access to the score. In every case, the subjects mutilated themselves in order to use their own blood to finish the piece, resulting in subsequent symptoms of psychosis and massive trauma. Those subjects who managed to finish a section of the piece immediately committed suicide, declaring the piece to be impossible to complete. Attempts to perform the music have resulted in a disagreeable cacophony, with each instrumental part having no correlation or harmony with the other instruments. Item number, SCP-13. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-13 are to be kept in a secure storage vault at Site 66. Exposed subjects are to be monitored for differences between their symptoms. Exposed subjects are to be interviewed daily, and any changes in perception are to be logged. Description: SCP-13 is the collective designation of 242 cigarettes, which display similar anomalies. The most common external detail between instances is the presence of the words Blue Lady, handwritten on each cigarette in blue ink. Subjects who consume the contents of SCP-13 through inhalation will begin to perceive themselves as a specific unidentified woman. Subjects have described the woman to be aged between 25 and 35 years old, standing approximately 1.6 meters tall, with an estimated weight of between 50 and 55 kilograms. Additional recurring details include cropped dark hair, blue eyes, and bright blue lipstick. Immediately after consuming an instance of SCP-13, subjects will gradually begin to perceive reflections of themselves as having the features of the woman, and will gradually perceive their bodies changing to reflect her appearance over the course of the following weeks. All changes are entirely mental. The subject's body does not change outwardly, only their perception of themselves. These alterations are permanent and cannot be reversed. SCP-13 was discovered after the suicide of an Ian Miles, packed in a large cardboard crate in his apartment. A cursory search of the apartment uncovered several hundred sketches of a figure strongly resembling the one perceived while under 13's effect. Miles's body had been found sitting at a desk, dead of a massive overdose, and draped over a handwritten note. During the investigation of Miles's apartment, one civilian investigator became affected by 13's effect. An embedded agent soon contacted the nearest site. The subject, the artifact, and related evidence were extracted and contained. Currently, 217 instances of SCP-13 cigarettes are contained at Biosite 66. 25 SCP-13 cigarettes are contained at Research Sector 9, pending future research into similar anomalous effects. Addendum: below is the note which was acquired along with SCP-13. I see her everywhere. That sad blue lady. I feel like I used to, should, do know her, but I can't remember. I love her, but I don't know why. She's so beautiful and sweet and clear, but I don't know anymore. Her favorite flavor. Where did you go? I miss you. Item number, SCP-20. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. Samples of SCP-20 are stored in a series of sealed cultivation chambers inside a sealed containment room at Biological Research Area 12, which is accessible only via airlock. Nutrients are administered via automated robotic systems, as the cultivation chamber must remain sealed at all times. Hermetically sealed video surveillance cameras are installed within the containment room and must be checked daily for integrity. Any personnel entering the containment room must wear biosafety level 5 equipment, including rebreathers, and undergo full antifungal disinfection upon exiting. Description: SCP-20 is a fast-spreading fungal organism that is capable of affecting the senses and behavior of living creatures, including humans. Samples of SCP-20 exhibit an unknown effect that renders them effectively invisible to direct observation, even when under a microscope. SCP-20 is only visible to humans when viewed through photographic or video surveillance. Once SCP-20 forms a colony, usually within a human residence, it will produce spores that affect the behavior of humans around it. Affected subjects will increase the heat and humidity within their homes to create an environment more suitable to the growth of SCP-20. Affected subjects also become more sociable in many cases, and often invite acquaintances to their homes to further spread the organism. As the spores and mold colonies are invisible to affected subjects, the mold may sometimes grow directly on living subjects. As the spores and colonies within a home approach critical concentration, the health of affected human subjects will rapidly deteriorate, resulting in death. Further spread of the mold may occur as the bodies of any deceased subjects are encountered by emergency responders and healthcare agents, as well as transportation of the bodies to local morgues. SCP-20 was first encountered in where an undercover SCP agent noted dramatic personality changes in personnel working at the local hospital. Upon investigation by a containment team, it was discovered that almost civilians had been infected, as well as a majority of the town. The civilian population was terminated, and the town incinerated under cover of a local flash forest fire. To date, over 12 outbreaks of SCP-20 have been reported. Investigations are currently underway to determine the source of these outbreaks and possible preventative measures. Addendum 20-01. Excerpts from the audio-video mission recorders of Mobile Task Force Ada 10, See No Evil, during the initial containment of SCP-20 on T2 lead, Team 2 moving to the Red House, T2 comm. Copy, UAV-1 is picking up one heat signature. T2 lead, Team 2 in place, ready to br- T2-2, door opening. At this point, a civilian woman appeared in the doorway, holding a kitchen knife. Video surveillance showed that nearly two-thirds of her face was covered by mold growths. Civilian woman: well, hello there, gentlemen. Care to take a breather inside? T2 lead: on the ground, drop the weapon. Civilian woman: don't be silly. Come on in and stay a while. T2 lead: stop where you are. Drop the weapon. Civilian woman: We just want to have some guests. Please come in. T2-2: drop that weapon. It is assumed that at this point, the infected civilian noticed T2-4 carrying a primed incendiary weapon and lunged forward at the team members with the knife. Civilian woman: data expunged. T2 lead: open fire! Open fire! Gunfire. Screaming. Item number, SCP-026. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-026 is to remain securely locked and boarded up at all times when there is no research ongoing. Alarms are set to alert the Foundation in case of entry by civilians or other agencies. Description: SCP-026 is a three-story public school building. It has two wings connected to a central foyer. It was declared condemned and after it was found the floor plan didn't match up to the building's blueprints. It came to the Foundation's attention after several disappearances in the area were linked to visits to the abandoned building. The following text has been struck through. The building demonstrates spatial anomalies. Its internal space is much greater than the external surface of the building would allow. Hallways display variable length, while stairways have differing numbers of steps going up or down. The number of rooms off the hallways changes each time they are counted. Attempts to reach the far ends of the hallways have met with failure thus far. Entrance through the fire escapes located at the ends of the hallways leads to doors approximately midway down the length of the halls. End of strike through. There is considerable graffiti on the interior walls of the school. Most appears typical, including gang signs, names, and street art. However, the graffiti fades and reappears, changing location. Writing on chalkboards and bulletin boards changes in a similar fashion. Subjects typically found range from standard school subjects, mathematics, literature, biology, to more esoteric subjects, such as quantum entanglement and eugenics. One researcher reported one board detailing information about SCP, but photographic evidence showed only a blank slate. The phrase, "the children used to sing," has appeared multiple times in various places throughout the building, but there is currently no explanation for its significance. A number of unconscious subjects have been found in the building, mostly of high school age, ranging from 12 to 18. They are dressed in accordance to the school's dress code, circa. Several have been identified as former students or faculty of the school who disappeared after the school shut down. In at least one case, more than 10 years after the closure. It is currently unknown how they were transported back into SCP-026. All attempts to wake the subjects while inside the building have failed. On being removed from the grounds of SCP-026, the subjects wake abruptly. They experience a period of confusion, before dying from extremely rapid dehydration, followed by advanced decomposition. No useful intelligence has been recovered from the subjects to date. The inability to wake subjects extends to those who fall asleep on the grounds of SCP-026, though the rapid dehydration only seems to affect those who have been found on the grounds of the school. See Incident Report 026-12. Note 026-A. Robotic explorations and video feeds have shown that the apparent spatial anomalies are caused by changes in the perceptions of observers, rather than actual spatial phenomena. For this reason, SCP-026 does not require the expertise of Mobile Task Force Row 8, Roadside Picnickers, at this time. Update: further exploration has shown that some spatial phenomena do occur. See the exploration logs for more details. Note 026-B. The contents of notepads, books, and pieces of paper have been observed to disappear, only to reappear on surfaces within SCP-026. New writings have appeared, mostly drawn from graffiti or textbooks. Caution should be exercised in bringing documents onto the grounds of SCP-026. Note 026-C. Several Class D personnel exposed to SCP-026 have disappeared from Foundation control, only to reappear inside the anomalous building. The subjects in question had previously complained of dreams identical to those experienced by Agent Malik. Incident Report 026-12. During a routine security check of SCP-026, Agent Malik was found unconscious by his partner, Agent Jones, in the main foyer. Initial attempts at rousing Agent Malik were ineffective, so he was moved for transportation to site. Upon leaving the grounds of SCP-026, he woke abruptly, in a state of agitation. When questioned, he revealed that he had been dreaming of a classroom setting. This dream has been consistent throughout all subjects who have fallen asleep within the grounds of SCP-026. Interview Log 026-01. Interview with former principal at SCP-026. Agent: thank you for your time, Mr. Principal: not at all. If there's one thing I have plenty of these days, it's time. Agent: so, let's get down to business. You were principal of back in, is that correct? Principal: yes, that's right. Agent: What can you tell us about that? Principal, well, you've heard the stories, I'm sure. Folks say it was haunted. I don't know about that, but things did seem strange toward the end. Agent, tell me about them. Principal, let's see. There were the stairs, of course. You've heard about that, right? People would count 15 coming up and 16 coming back down. I'm sure there was a trick to it, like an optical illusion, but I never could figure it out. And we had a history book that turned up completely blank. I suppose these seem rather tame, but you know how it is. Little things add up. People tell stories. Agent, tell me about the dreams. Principal, the dreams. Oh, yes. People were complaining about nightmares. Mostly students, but a few of the staff as well. It was always about school never ending. We joked about it at first, but more people talked about it. I didn't put much credence into it, but, well, when we found the blueprints didn't match up with the school, it seemed easier to just move to a new building. The schoolhouse was old anyway, and we wanted a fresh start. And, just like that, things seemed to settle back to normal. Agent, I see. Is there anything else you'd like to add? Principal, It's not really much, but maybe we'll make a nice footnote in that book you're writing. I still sometimes have dreams about being in my office, back at the old schoolhouse. Sometimes I'm just doing paperwork. Sometimes I'm talking to someone, but it's always back behind the desk, just like old times. But gradually, I notice something's a bit off. The bell's ringing, but I don't hear anyone in the hallway. No students hurrying in or out of the classroom. No chatter, no footsteps, nothing but the bell. And it doesn't stop. The crazy thing is that I never notice it's a dream until then. I've been retired for 10 years, but until I notice the bell, I think everything's normal. Crazy, isn't it? Agent, I think it's very interesting. Thank you very much. If you think of anything else, don't hesitate to give me a call. Principal, anytime. Interview log 026-08. Doctor, please have a seat. Agent Walker, thank you. Doctor, let's get down to business. I understand you're requesting a transfer out of fieldwork. Would you like to talk about that? Agent Walker, I'd rather not. Doctor, it's your choice. However, I can't approve a transfer without reason. Agent Walker, look, You've seen my record. You know I worked on 26, right? Doctor, I've read the report. Agent Walker, I was there the first time we took one of the sleepers out. A lot of them were adults when they disappeared, but they're kids again when we find them. So, I see this 16-year-old boy just kind of shrivel away. I had nightmares that night. Doctor, you're supposed to report any unusual dreams after contacting a potentially mind-altering phenomenon. Agent Walker, it hadn't been declared a mind screw yet. We just thought it was a weird space thing. We were just watching it until the picnickers got there. And it was a shock, you know? We weren't expecting anything like that. Anyway, I got over it quick enough. I'd seen worse. I once had a guy melt while I was holding on to him. Doctor, I see. What happened next? Agent Walker, nothing for a while. I went in a couple of times, but didn't see anything too weird. But, look, I know I should have reported it. But one of my buddies had just been disappeared after getting touched by some weird SCP, and I don't want it to happen to me. Doctor, you've been affected by an SCP. Agent Walker, Yeah. It was a week later. I was dozing in the back of the van, and I started dreaming. Doctor, can you describe this dream? Agent Walker, just like the others. You've read the reports, right? Doctor, pretend that I haven't. For the record, Agent Walker. Agent Walker, all right. I'm in a classroom. It's just like one of the ones in 026, but new, not falling apart. I knew the teacher's name. I knew who was sitting by me, even though I'd never seen most of them before. The bell started ringing, but no one moved. I raised my hand, but the teacher didn't notice. Finally, I tried to leave, but the door wouldn't open. Then I noticed something strange with my hand. It had color. Everything else was black and white, but I felt like I was the one who was wrong, out of place, and that's when I woke up. The van was leaving. No one else noticed I'd been asleep. Doctor, and you didn't think to report this? Agent Walker, like I said, I was scared, and this was before they found Malik. I figured it was just another nightmare. Nothing weird. And after Malik had his dream, well, they didn't do anything with him, so I figured it wasn't a big deal. Doctor, he was put on observation. You should have been as well, for your own safety and for the safety of others. Agent Walker, you paper pushers think it's all so easy, don't you? Sitting behind a desk all day, you don't know what it's like. Well, things aren't so clear out there. Not when you're the one hunting talking cats in a sewer, or waiting to see if you're the one who's not going to come back this time. Agent Walker was visibly distressed. It was several minutes before he calmed down enough to continue the interview. Agent Walker, anyway, it wasn't until later that we connected the dreams with the sleepers. Not until they found those Class Ds on the second floor. Still, I thought I might be okay. I wasn't actually inside of 26 when I dreamed. I wasn't sure until the dreams started. Doctor, you're having reoccurrences? Agent Walker, yeah. They started 6 months ago. It's the same dream. But each time, it takes me a little longer to notice it isn't real. And when I look at my hands, they're a little more gray. End interview 026-31. Note, Agent Walker has since been given a Class A amnesiac and returned to fieldwork. Exploration log 026-4. Exploration conducted by Agent... Alright, I'm walking into the lobby. Walls are mostly bare concrete, a little paint here and there. Graffiti everywhere. A few beer bottles, some other trash. Looks like just another abandoned building. Okay, I'm making my way up the stairs. More graffiti on the walls. Okay, I'm going into the hallway. The peeling paint is kind of creepy. Looks like some sort of sheet fungus. Reminds me of... The doors are kind of weird. Some are really close, others are far. Really irregular spacing. Doesn't match up with the blueprint you showed me. Okay, here's a classroom. Pretty empty. Some old desks. Real old, like they had in the 30s. The chalkboard's got a few math problems on it. Looks like trig. Okay, I'm going to check out another room. Back in the hallway. Heading to the next room. Desks look more modern in this room. Made from particle board. More posters here. Look to be from the 80s, I'd say. I recognize some of them from when I was a kid. Looks like Latin on the chalkboard. Yes, I'm taking pictures. Okay, back in the hallway. Heading to the next room. Several minutes of silence. There's something really screwy with this place. I could swear the room was just a few feet away, but it feels like I've been walking for hours. Anyway, I'm here. We've got sleepers. Three of them, two girls and a boy. They look to be around 14, 15. They're all wearing the same uniform. Yeah, just like you showed me. Hang on a minute while I take some pictures. At least we can figure out who they are. The furniture's pretty old looking, what's left of it. A lot of broken chairs and desks. Nothing on the walls. Chalkboards. The hell? You're not going to believe this. It's got Agent's notes up there. In her handwriting, even. We're going to have to be really careful what we bring in here. Yeah, I've got pictures, don't worry. Okay, I'm going to check one more room, and then I'm out. Back in the hallway now, heading for the next room. Another anomaly. I've been going the same direction this entire time, but I'm back at the stairs. Yeah, I'm just going to head down. I've had enough of this place for one day. I'll meet you at the door. The developed photos revealed. Exploration log 026-12. Carried out remotely using a robotic drone via video feed. Exploring the first floor hallway. The hallway appeared in poor condition, with graffiti on the walls. Comparison with previous videos shows the graffiti has changed. Many of the same signs were present, but in different positions. Some seemed new. Doors were uniformly spaced on the wall. Some were intact, while others were cracked or missing entirely. First room in the hallway was the girls' bathroom. More graffiti on the walls. Several broken mirrors. A toilet had been removed from the wall entirely and placed in the center of the room. There was a great deal of porcelain and glass on the floor. The next room over was the boys' bathroom. This was skipped in favor of exploring the classrooms. The first classroom had no furniture. The chalkboard was broken in two. On one side of the board, there was a set of lines reading, "I will not pass notes during class. Sick." The other side had fragments of a lesson on... There was one poster on the wall, depicting Helen Keller. The second classroom was well furnished, with the largest number of intact desks to date, mostly made from wood and steel in a style used in the 1950s. There were two sleepers found that had not been reported in previous sweeps of the building. The first was a male teenager in a student's desk. Comparison with file 026-04 revealed him to be a former student of the school. He was reported missing 10 years after the school closed down, at age 28. The other was a woman in her mid-30s, sitting behind the teacher's desk. Her identity is still unknown. The chalkboard had a timeline of World War II, overlaid with an intricate piece of graffiti. The third classroom had 15 particle board desks in various states of disrepair. A map on the back wall was consistent with the socio-political conditions of 1974. A bookshelf had collapsed and spilled a set of encyclopedias onto the floor. The robot was then guided to the end of the hallway and back to the entrance. There was no sign of spatial anomalies at this time. Exploration log 026-15. Exploration conducted by Agent accompanied by a robotic drone. Okay, I'm in. Lobby looks like it always does. Probably some graffiti drift. Here comes the robot. The lobby was compared to previous videos. Some differences in the graffiti were noted. Otherwise, no significant changes. I'm heading upstairs now. God damn, the robot's heavy. How much crap did you load on it? You could have warned me. Gonna rest a second on the second landing. Video coming in all right? Cool. First set of stairs was navigated without trouble. The second floor hallway appeared similar to the first floor hallway, though with less debris. I've caught my breath, heading up to the third floor. Wish there was a guardrail. Next time it might be easier to carry the robot and the gear separately, and load it in once it's up. The gear is pretty idiot-proof. I think I could probably figure it out. Damn thing must weigh over 100 pounds. There, on the third floor now. I count 12 doors. Weird spacing. That last door's got to be at least 100 yards down. This place is pretty messed up. Rangefinder showed the hallway was approximately 45 meters long. 5 doors on each side, evenly spaced, with one more door at the end of the hall. 11 total. I'm heading in. There's not as much graffiti up here. A bit of debris. I'm opening one of the doors. Janitor's closet and... hey, we've got a janitor. He's sleeping standing up. That's new. Male. Seems to be in his mid-50s. Name tag says... couple old broomsticks. What's left of a mop. Looks like rats have been nesting in here. They've shredded one of his pant legs. But looks like they didn't touch the sleeper himself. What? You want samples? Eh, sure. Wouldn't be the weirdest thing I've picked up for this job. Okay, I think that's it. Comparison with file 026-4 revealed the sleeper to be former janitor in SCP-026. Later analysis of the rat feces revealed recommended future exploration teams wear biohazard gear. Here's a classroom. No sleepers. Couple of desks intact, the rest look pretty bad. Looks like someone took a sledgehammer to the place. No, wait, I stand corrected. Baseball bat. It's leaning against the corner. There's about half a case of beer here, full cans. Looks like they left in a hurry. Hey, get the robot to face the board. There's something I want you to see. Looks like Latin to me. Could be significant. Get someone to translate it. It might be a clue to what's gone down here. The Latin was found to be a series of sentences showing different conjugations of the verb vendir, to sell. All were found in its Latin primer. A textbook formerly used by the school. The baseball bat was aluminum. An analysis of the fingerprints was inconclusive. Okay, next classroom. Desks look fairly modern. 80s, I'd guess. Chalkboard's got a quote from Nicholas Nickleby on it. Yes, I'm sure. It says right there on the board. The sun does not shine upon this fair earth to meet frowning eyes. Depend upon it. Nicholas Nickleby, by Charles Dickens. There's an apple on the desk. Looks fresh. I'm tossing it into the drone. Okay, I'm looking out the window. Hey, are you guys still out there? Because I see kids in the schoolyard. I don't see the van or any of you. Yeah, second classroom on the right. You see me? Weird. The apple appeared fresh on the video feed. However, when removed from the sample's bin, it was in an advanced state of decomposition. The drone's feed through the window showed the Foundation van on the ground. And the research team looking up at the window. No children were seen in the schoolyard. Okay, you want me to head down the hallway? Alright. Let's see if I actually make it this time. Not holding out any hopes. Walking forward. It looks 10 feet to the next door. which would actually put it in the last room. But who's counting? I'm still here. I'm just farther than it looks. Feels like I've been walking at least a couple of hours. I'm almost there. I'm just going to take a breather. Okay, this is wrong. I've stopped moving, but now I'm going backwards. The hallway's moving past me. Shit, I just saw the door move past me. I'm moving forward again. That's better. Okay, I'm almost there. One last dash and I should make it. And I'm back with the robot. I knew it wasn't going to work. There's no way to get there, I'm telling you. The video feed showed the next door was 30 feet away. The total elapsed time from one door to the next was 5 minutes, in which time Agent meandered toward the end of the hallway. No anomalous activity was observed while he was standing still. When he neared the end of the hallway, Agent turned around and quickly returned to the beginning of the hallway. Okay, I hear you. I've got my eyes closed. I'm walking forward. Left, got it. Going straight. Correcting left again. Correcting right now. Okay, this is going a lot faster. Okay, correcting right. Yes, right, I heard you. God damn it, I am going right. Okay, left. No, it is not the same direction. Look, if you think it's that easy, just send the robot in. The robot was able to reach the end of the hallway with no problems. Agent attempted to follow, but was unable to keep a straight line to the end of the hallway. Just go ahead and send the bot in. I'm not going to try again until we have a better idea of what's in there. Something's keeping me out of there. We should figure out what it is before anything else. Look, if you want to know that badly, go yourself, or request some Class Ds. I'm not going in. Deal with it. At this point, the robot opened the door and crossed the threshold into another hallway, running perpendicular to the first, 30 meters in length. No doors were visible. A single window was observed, but was situated too high for the view outside to be visible. The walls were free of graffiti. The left was a dead end, while the right terminated in a left-hand turn. The robot turned right into the new hallway. After 10 meters, the unit's GPS showed it to be outside the building. Though the video feed still showed the hallway, it continued to the end of the hallway and turned left. Agent was just ahead, at the beginning of the original hallway. Turning the camera behind the robot showed only the stairwell, with no sign of the second hallway. The unit's GPS showed it by Agent's position at this time. I see another classroom. I don't see the robot, though. I lost track after it went through the door. What do you mean it's outside? Did it go out through the window? Look, maybe the GPS is screwy. Calm down. What do you mean turn around? What the hell am I? Oh, f***. Okay, that's enough. I'm calling it off for the day. We can come back after we get some Class Ds in here. Item number, SCP-028. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. No special means are needed to contain at this time, as SCP-028 has not shown any change in size, position, or shape during the entire period of its containment, but access must be restricted. Currently, SCP-028 is contained on-site, site as SCP-028 is not transportable by any known means. SCP-028 is sealed in a 6-meter by 6-meter by 3-meter, 20-meter by 20-meter by 10-meter foot, concrete room with a single door, with two armed personnel stationed outside. Only authorized personnel are to be allowed exposure to SCP-028, and extreme care must be taken at all times. While SCP-028 is itself harmless, the effect can be very damaging to the unprepared. See document EL-028-1125. Description: SCP-028 is located in an abandoned storage yard outside a copper mine in northern Michigan. SCP-028 has no detectable physical presence of any kind, but its effect occurs in a 2.1 meter, 7 foot cube around what is commonly held as the center of SCP-028. All forms of scanning and testing in the area of SCP-028 have shown no abnormal readings. Adding or removing objects, or attempting to remove dirt from under SCP-028, has no effect in altering the size or shape of SCP-028's area of effect, nor the onset or quality of the effect. Subjects entering SCP-028 are, within 3 to 6 seconds, struck by total and complete knowledge of a subject. This knowledge is thus far completely random in both size and usefulness, and sometimes goes unnoticed for extended periods of time. More profound knowledge generally has a stronger effect, with some cases expunged. See document EL-028-1125. This effect can be experienced multiple times by exiting and re-entering SCP-028, but can result in increasingly strong migraines and dizziness after two exposures. SCP-028 came to the Foundation's attention after research into news reports of a local miner who submitted a design for a cold fusion reactor to the U.S. Patent Office. Mr. reported that it just came to me, like a bolt out of the blue. News and subjects were suppressed and contained after discovery of SCP-028 and the reactor designs implemented in the containment of SCP-1995. Subsequent testing of SCP-028 has yielded mixed results. Document number EL-028-1114. Partial information retrieval log for January 5th. Note: all knowledge is perfect, total, and eidetic. Every phone book entry for New York City in 1998. How to redesign the internal combustion engine to run on human blood, using only pre-existing parts. Note: full redesign takes 4 hours, and runs at higher efficiency than gasoline. Location of keys for a Buick LeSabre. The proper method of care for a mole rat colony. Origin and history of 12 SCP objects. Note: the main expunged. Family history of the Blackthorn family, located in London, England. Geological structure of the Earth beneath Greenland, including several unknown caves, and expunged. Document number EL-028-1125. Log E-112. Subject D-1182 exposed to SCP-028. Subject began to cry and went into fetal position, showing signs of high distress. Unresponsive to questioning and outside stimulus for several days, lapsed into catatonia shortly after stating that this is not life. Subject passed into a coma and died shortly thereafter. COD was attributed to shock. E-127. Agent accidentally exposed to SCP-028. Agent showed signs of sudden surprise and bemusement. When questioned, agent requested, "A moment to gather my thoughts, please." After several seconds, agent laughed, shook his head, and removed his service pistol from its holster. Agent then shot and wounded Dr. and killed agents and before being restrained. Post-incident interrogation revealed agent had extensive knowledge of classified Foundation activities and several SCP objects he had not been previously exposed to, including SCP-2669. Any Foundation personnel found to have entered SCP-028's area of effect are to be detained indefinitely. Document number EL-028-1128. Log. Experiment 189. Subject D-9843 was exposed to SCP-028. Examination of subject revealed abnormal respiratory actions. Questioning revealed subject had learned to recycle the carbon dioxide inside his body. Repeated attempts to teach the skill to other D-class personnel failed. Subject terminated. Autopsy reveals no abnormal organ formations. Researchers notes, Dr. Seriously, how the hell did he do that? Item number, SCP-029. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. SCP-029 is to be incarcerated in a Class 5 containment cell. She is to be allowed access to nothing of a physical nature. Her containment cell is to be placed behind a triple airlock to avoid her escape. As a result of Incident 029-34A, SCP-029 is no longer to be fed, as she does not appear to need sustenance to survive. There are to be 3 guards on duty at all times on her cell, and 2 guards on monitor duty. Floodlights have been installed in the walls of the containment chamber, and are to be on at all times. Once a month, the chamber is to be cleaned and checked for defects. Under absolutely no circumstances are any men to encounter SCP-029 in any manner. Any males who do encounter SCP-029 are to be held under Class 3 detention for interviewing before termination. SCP-029 is requested a bed, denied. A blanket, denied. Books, denied. Clothes, denied. This is ridiculous. The girl can't even have clothes. We are not animals. Let her cover herself. Dr. Erica Bodine. Dr. Bodine, you are granted permission to deliver clothes to SCP-029. Dr. Light. As of Incident 029-53B, anyone who has potential access to SCP-029 is required to first watch Surveillance Tape 029 Bodine as a reminder of threats involved when working with SCP items and SCP-029 in particular. Description: SCP-029 appears to be a pubescent female of Asiatic Indian descent. She appears to suffer from alopecia universalis. Over 80% of her pigmentation is a true black, while the rest of her skin has a complete lack of melanin, to the point of albinism. Her eyes are also a dark black in color. SCP-029 has severe homicidal tendencies and has displayed a remarkable ability to use any item as a weapon. However, she has a severe compulsion against shedding blood, preferring instead to strangle her victims. SCP-029 has demonstrated dexterity and physical reactions 4 times as fast as the average human. SCP-029 has also displayed extensive resistance to damage of all forms. Both of these extrahuman abilities are greatly hampered in the presences of bright or direct light, natural or artificial. In addition, any males who come within the presence of SCP-029, an area defined by her current perception, find themselves pliant to her will. Such males become willing to kill or even die for SCP-029. SCP-029 refers to herself as, which roughly translates to Daughter of Darkness, Daughter of Shadows, or Daughter of Night. Interviews with SCP-029 have proven difficult to conduct due to SCP-029's constant attempts to kill or convert all who speak with her. Over her years of captivity, the black patches on her skin have increased in size. SCP-029 was first brought to the Foundation's attention by an agent working in rural India. An attempt on his life led him to a small cult of men who claimed to be thuggies in service to the daughter. Several weeks of investigation proved that they believed the world to be in the last years of the Kali Yuga, and that by sacrificing 1 million lives to the Daughter of Darkness, they could raise their goddess and end the world. They also believed that only sacrifices performed through strangulation added to this tally. Events led the agent to their mountain fortress, where he discovered SCP-029. After the loss of said agent, data expunged, which ended in our acquisition of SCP-029. Addendum: 7 years after capture, SCP-029 began showing anomalous growth in her black pigmentation. When questioned about it, she claimed her followers were on the move once more. Investigation led us to a concentration of so-called thuggies that had escaped our initial foray. After discovering that all of her followers were there for one of their holy days, a tactical airstrike was called in. When the first bomb dropped, SCP-029 awoke from slumber, screaming at the top of her lungs. SCP-029 continued to scream for the next 4 hours, ranting and raving that we were killing her people. Since said event, the growth of black pigmentation has stopped completely. Also since said event, SCP-029 has redoubled her efforts to escape. SCP-2820 has been proposed as a possible method of neutralization should this situation worsen. Item number: SCP-035. Object Class: Keter. Special Containment Procedures: SCP-035 is to be kept within a hermetically sealed glass case, no fewer than 10 centimeters, 4 inches, thick. This case is to be contained within a steel, iron, and lead-shielded room at all times. Doors are to be triple-locked at all times, with the exception of allowing personnel in or out. No fewer than 2 armed guards are to be posted at any time. Guards must remain outside at all times, and are not allowed within the containment room under any circumstances. A trained psychologist is to remain on site at all times. Research personnel are not to touch SCP-035 at any time. SCP-035 must be moved to a new sealed case every 2 weeks. The previous case must be disposed of via SCP-101, as it shows no adverse reactions to SCP-035's corruption. Anyone who comes into contact with SCP-035 when it is in possession of a host is to be given an immediate psychological evaluation. Description: SCP-035 appears to be a white porcelain comedy mask, although, at times, it will change to tragedy. In these events, all existing visual records, such as photographs, video footage, even illustrations of SCP-035 automatically change to reflect its new appearance. A highly corrosive and degenerative viscous liquid constantly seeps from the eye and mouth holes of SCP-035. Anything coming into contact with this substance slowly decays over a period of time, depending on the material, until it has decayed completely into a pool of the original contaminant. Glass seems to react the slowest to the effects of the item, hence the construction choice of its immediate container. Living organisms that come into contact with the substance react much the same way, with no chance of recovery. Origin of the liquid is unknown. Liquid is only visible from the front, and does not emerge or is even visible from the other side. Subjects within 1.5 to 2 meters, 5 or 6 feet, of SCP-035, or in visual contact with it, experience a strong urge to put it on. When SCP-035 is placed on the face of an individual, an alternate brainwave pattern from SCP-035 overlaps that of the original host, effectively snuffing it out and causing brain death to the subject. Subject then claims to be the consciousness contained within SCP-035. The bodies of possessed subjects decay at a highly accelerated rate, eventually becoming little more than mummified corpses. Nevertheless, SCP-035 has demonstrated the ability to remain in cognitive control of a body, experiencing severe structural damage, even if the subject's body literally decays to the point where motion is not mechanically possible. No effect is found to be had when placed on the face of an animal. Conversations with SCP-035 have proven to be informative. Researchers have learned various details about other SCP objects and history in general, as SCP-035 claims to have been at many momentous events. SCP-035 displays a highly intelligent and charismatic personality, being both amiable and flattering to all those who speak with it. SCP-035 has scored in the 99th percentile on all intelligence and aptitude tests administered to it, and appears to have a photographic memory. However, psychological analysis has discovered SCP-035 to possess a highly manipulative nature, capable of forcing sudden and profound changes to interviewers' psychological state. SCP-035 has proven to be highly sadistic, prompting some to commit suicide, and transforming others into near-mindless servants with linguistic persuasion alone. SCP-035 has stated that it has intimate knowledge of the workings of the human mind, and implied that it could change anyone's views if given enough time. Additional notes. SCP-035 was found in a sealed crypt in an abandoned house in Venice in 18... Addendum 035-01. SCP-035 has been found to be able to possess anything that has a humanoid shape, including mannequins, corpses, and statues. SCP-035 has been able to motivate all into movement, removing the need to expose live subjects to SCP-035. Still, anything it possesses inevitably decays into motionlessness. Addendum 035-02. SCP-035 has facilitated an escape attempt, convincing several of the research staff to aid it in its bid for freedom. Insurrection failed. All staff that have been in contact with SCP-035 have been terminated, and mandatory psychiatric evaluations have been implemented for all personnel coming in contact with SCP-035. Addendum 035-03. It has been determined that SCP-035 is capable of telepathy, whether or not it possesses a host, even penetrating to the subconscious of others, and using the knowledge it finds to its advantage. Extreme caution is advised when choosing subjects to converse with SCP-035. Addendum 035-04. SCP-035 has expressed an interest in other SCPs, most notably SCP-4715 and SCP-682. Dr. has expressed worry that should SCP-035 bond with either, their regenerative qualities would negate its corruption and give it a permanent host. Addendum 035-05. After several more escape attempts, and after reviewing SCP-035's incident record, High Command has ordered that it be permanently sealed within the facility and prohibited from being allowed any more hosts. Several personnel have protested against this, with some even erupting into violence. As a direct result, all personnel that have come into contact with SCP-035 have been terminated. Going forward, all personnel that deal with SCP-035 are to be rotated frequently, and contact is to be limited even to its dormant state to as little as possible. Addendum 035-06. Personnel within 10 meters of SCP-035 have recently reported feeling unease, stating that they can hear unintelligible whispering. Several others have suffered from severe migraines. Object has been monitored, but there is no change in its dormant behavior, and no sounds have been recorded. The motion to reinstate SCP-035's host privileges has been brought up once more, if only on a temporary basis, to discover these new changes in the object's behavior. Denied. Addendum 035-07. The walls of SCP-035's containment cell have suddenly begun secreting a black substance. Tests on the substance have revealed it to be human blood, although highly contaminated with several foreign and unknown agents. Substance is corrosive, having a pH balance of 4.5, and prolonged exposure to the walls has proven to be detrimental to their structural integrity. More notably, it seems to be forming patterns on the walls. Several segments seem to be paragraphs in various languages, including Italian, Latin, Greek, and Sanskrit. Translation is pending. Other segments appear to be diagrams depicting ritualistic sacrifice and mutilation, often for the arcane benefit of the person committing them. Several staff members have been shocked to note that all of the sacrifices bear an uncanny resemblance to various personnel and their loved ones, often in conflicting positions. Researchers while in the room examining these newly formed patterns have complained of hearing loud whispering and high-pitched, unnerving laughter at irregular intervals. Personnel in the section working daily near and around SCP-035's containment unit have suffered catastrophic morale damage, with an all-time high in suicide rates in staff in that area, whether or not they have ever had contact with SCP-035. The only change in SCP-035's dormant behavior is regarding its contained glass case. Degradation of the case has increased to a high degree, enough so that the glass will occasionally shatter, causing a wide dispersal of SCP-035's contaminant. This occurs quite often at the most inopportune times, so far resulting in 6 casualties and 3 fatalities of both research and cleanup staff. Addendum 035-08. In light of the mass suicide and homicide of the members of the research team tasked with translating the passages garnered from SCP-035's containment cell, the morale damage in the area, and general loss of staff dealing with SCP-035 to either death or insanity, it has been decided to coat the inner and outer walls of its containment cell with SCP-148, which has proved well in the containment of SCP-132, in order to hopefully block out the high levels of negativity being emitted by SCP-035. Addendum 035-09. The use of SCP-148 has worked well, causing morale and suicide rates to return to near pre-SCP-035 rates. However, the material appears to facilitate the negativity within the cell, causing a veritable greenhouse effect inside. Personnel inside the cell have stated that they feel a heavy sense of dread, fear, anger, and general depression, as well as hearing constant, nearly inaudible whispering upon immediate entry. A prolonged stay causes severe migraines, suicidal tendencies, heavy hemorrhaging of blood vessels around the eyes and inside the mouth and nose, general hostility to others, and for the whispering to increase to almost deafening volumes, intersected by a constant mocking laughter. Exposure of more than 3 hours inevitably results in the subject falling into a deep psychosis and attempting to harm either themselves or others. Most spoke in Latin or Greek, despite the fact that several did not previously know how to speak said languages beforehand. The presence of blood in both word and diagram formations has increased disproportionately, the walls becoming cluttered and the formations beginning to overlap each other. The substance has proven to be both difficult to clean and even more corrosive than was originally recorded, with a pH of roughly 2.4. General estimation gives the current walls a life of 2 months before they will need replacement. It is becoming gradually more and more difficult to contain SCP-035, and the debate to reinstate its host privileges has once again come up. Denied. Addendum 035-10. The walls, ceiling, and floor of SCP-035's containment cell have now been completely saturated in blood. All personnel entering and guarding the area must wear full hazmat protection suits. Constant cleaning efforts are being instated. Addendum 035-11. The magnitude, intensity, and recurrence of the phenomena that occur within SCP-035's containment cell have increased to an alarming degree. The cell door has been known to become locked of its own accord while personnel are inside and unable to be opened for a period of time. Appendages form out of the larger puddles of blood and often attempt to grab or harm personnel near them. Blurry apparitions have started appearing to staff. Electronic devices no longer work inside the cell, and the light cannot be turned on, though there is no physical reason why it does not work, forcing those entering to use non-electric-based light sources. Cleaning measures are having no discernible effect on the cell, and the walls are degrading at a very high rate, forcing them to be replaced within a week at best, although the blood makes it nearly impossible to properly achieve this. SCP-035 may have to be moved to a new cell entirely, with the old one sealed off and disengaged from the rest of the facility. Item Number SCP-042. Object Class: Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-042 is currently housed within Minimum Security Paddock 12 at Bioresearch Area 32. Despite SCP-042's seeming disinclination to attempt escape at this point, security measures must still be maintained at all times. Previous attempts to maintain the health of the ground cover in Paddock 12 have failed to date. Despite regular watering, SCP-042's presence leaves the ground parched wherever it treads. As it has not been determined what happens to added water, the program of watering has been discontinued as unnecessary and potentially hazardous to the local water table. Monitoring of local well levels and sampling of the area's water is to be carried out on a weekly basis. Personnel interacting with SCP-042, including any handlers, medical personnel, feeders, and custodial staff, must submit to a thorough search, including prior to entrance into Paddock 12. Any personnel attempting to smuggle a weapon or an object which can be used as a weapon is to be immediately. Personnel are to undergo psychological screening once per week after interacting in any way with SCP-042. Medical personnel examining the wounds on SCP-042's back are to be closely monitored at all times, lest they attempt to euthanize SCP-042. Description: SCP-042 is an animal believed to be a member of the genus Equus. Its coat is white in color, with some small brown spotting. It stands at 183 centimeters, or 18 hands, to its withers, and weighs 710 kilograms. Its weight has dropped significantly since it has been in Foundation custody, due to both atrophy from lack of physical activity and refusal to eat. The liquid nutrient diet forcibly administered keeps it alive, but it remains emaciated and weak. SCP-042 exhibits two large bone protrusions from its back, linked to powerful musculature, now atrophied, throughout its back. These bones end at 37 centimeters from the surface of its back, and they protrude from the skin at open, ragged wounds. To date, no healing has been observed of these wounds, though some clotting must be taking place for SCP-042 to have not bled out. SCP-042 exhibits a listless demeanor and has been unresponsive to any attempt by skilled handlers to incite activity. If allowed to do so, SCP-042 will lay down on the ground immobile, not moving to eat, drink, or relieve itself. Pain response conditioning has proved somewhat effective in getting SCP-042 to rise so that it can be cleaned, but eventually it will attempt to lay down again no matter the strength of the shock administered, even to the point of losing consciousness. Researchers are divided as to SCP-042's level of intelligence. While some believe that it is simply an animal and no smarter than others of its genus, others have come to believe that it may in fact be sapient. It has been shown to make eye contact with persons entering Paddock 12, most of whom describe its looks as pleading. SCP-042 has been involved in accidents on multiple occasions, where it has been injured on pieces of equipment or its enclosure, which those arguing for intelligence believe to have been intentionally caused by SCP-042. Addendum. A request was submitted by Dr. P to transfer SCP-042 to Bioresearch Area 4 on 19, which was approved by 05-5. Dr. P altered transportation documents to indicate that SCP-042 was to be airlifted rather than transported by armed convoy. During transit, Dr. P overpowered the pilot of the transport aircraft and took the controls, plunging the craft into a steep dive. Passengers and cargo experienced nearly a minute of weightlessness before security personnel regained control of the aircraft and leveled off. As Dr. P was being bound and the plane landed, SCP-042 broke free of containment and kicked two security personnel to death in the cargo area. Cargo bay security footage shows that after this point, SCP-042 approached Dr. P and touched its muzzle to his face. Dr. P exhibited signs of euphoria while contact was maintained, but when additional security personnel subdued SCP-042 with tranquilizer darts and contact was broken, he collapsed into a catatonic state from which he did not recover. After a hearing concerning his actions, Dr. P was euthanized while under Foundation medical care on 19. Item number, SCP-053. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-053 is to be contained in an area no less than 5 meters by 5 meters, 16 feet by 16 feet, and given adequate room to move. Toys, books, games, and other recreational devices are to be amply provided and rotated every 3 months. Proper bedding, bathroom, and medical facilities are to be maintained at all times. Food should be provided 3 times daily, and 2 snacks are allowed if requested. No physical contact is to be made with SCP-053 without full atmosphere containment suit and eye shield. No eye contact is to be made with SCP-053 for any reason. Any objects given to personnel by SCP-053 may be removed, but must be given to quarantine for examination. Only one member of personnel may be present in the room at any given time, and must be secured by a safety line of steel cable. All personnel must be removed from SCP-053's containment chamber within 10 minutes of entering. Any personnel who begin to act erratically, scream, or attempt to grab SCP-053 are to be removed and quarantined. Any personnel attempting to remove their suit are also to be removed and quarantined. No sharp objects or firearms are allowed in SCP-053's containment room. Description. SCP-053 appears to be a small 3-year-old girl. She is capable of basic speech and appears to be slightly above average in mental development. She has a generally pleasant personality and rarely seems upset, becoming agitated only in the presence of groups of people. Any and all humans over the age of 3 who make eye contact with, physically touch, or remain around SCP-053 for longer than 10 minutes will rapidly become irrational, paranoid, and homicidal. Most, if not all, of these feelings will be directed at SCP-053, and afflicted subjects will attempt to kill SCP-053 after first killing or driving off all humans visible to them. Those attempting to kill SCP-053 will suffer massive heart attacks or seizures, and die seconds after doing any physical damage to SCP-053. SCP-053 will regenerate almost instantaneously from any wound, regardless of severity. SCP-053 appears wholly ignorant of these effects, and ignores any and all subjects affected. When questioned about the effect, SCP-053 is incapable of response. Item number, SCP-056. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-056 is to be kept in a room of its choosing, with whatever furnishings it expresses desire for. Level 1 personnel and above may interact with SCP-056 at any time they choose, for a time length not exceeding 2 hours. The subject is to be guarded by a minimum of 3 security staff at all times, with shift changes every 4 hours. Each guard is to be armed with non-lethal tranquilizer pistols, loaded with no less than 1,500 microliters of cyclopyrrolone and tranquilizer. Any irregularities in personnel and staff developed by extended exposure to SCP-056 will result in psychological examination and relocation to site data expunged. The subject is to be allowed access to any object it desires, with the exception of weapons, communication devices, an internet connection, and other SCP objects. It may wander in research sector as it wills, but never allowed access to floors with exits. In the event of an emergency, or if SCP-056 becomes violent, it is to be subdued and contained within its room if possible. At no time should personnel attempt to harm SCP-056. Description: SCP-056 is a being of variable size, gender, and appearance, which changes in response to the environment around it, especially in regards to living and sentient beings. Its most common form is of a handsome man in his middle 20s, dressed in a garb of similar appearance to that of the personnel guarding it, but of a higher quality and aesthetic value. However, it has been recorded as taking these forms: a large, well-groomed Labrador retriever when exposed to Dr.'s dog, a woman of similar appearance to famous actress Scarlett Johansson when passing by a group of younger female staff, a female doctor in a white lab coat when speaking with various researchers. When asked to take an IQ test, the subject scored nearly 30 points higher than the highest scoring researcher available. A male bodybuilder who was able to lift nearly 250 kilograms twice on a bench press machine in the sector's gym. This was 30 kilograms heavier than the strongest security guard's maximum at the time. A couch of extremely pleasing aesthetic value when left alone in the subject's room. These changes will generally occur the moment all people in the area lose focus on the subject, which occurs immediately upon exposure to a new object or person. Filming these changes has proved inconsequential, as any viewing the tapes or feed suffer the same momentary confusion. Clothing will also change during this time, though 056 has yet to manifest any sort of tools or weapons. It is theoretically impossible to view SCP-056's original or natural form. When left in an empty concrete cell and under closed-loop video surveillance, it took on the form of a higher-quality camera and appeared to monitor the camera watching it. Further attempts to yield its natural form discovered that when alone, it had no readable life signs, including body temperature, heartbeat, or weight. It is assumed by researchers that it could not exist without any sort of perception. Personnel in contact with the subject often report feeling jealous or unsatisfied, yet will often give a great deal of both positive and negative attention to SCP-056, which can be predicted by their personality types. Security staff will often claim that they wish to follow the subject's commands, even if they dislike it or its current form, while researchers in extended contact with it will often try to argue and verbally abuse it, which usually results in the subject sending them out in shame. SCP-056 is quite capable of speech, and can apparently communicate in any language, verbal or not, and has shown fluency in over 200 dialects, including those invented by cryptographers and hobbyists. It frequently treats the staff around it with disdain, though is generally willing to do whatever is asked of it, so long as the inquiring does so in a submissive way. It expresses interest in magazines, fashion, automobiles, theoretical science, sports, and a multitude of other subjects, usually expressing greater knowledge and understanding of the topic than the person communicating with it. Personnel will generally become angry, disenchanted, or disgusted with SCP-056 after speaking with it for great lengths of time, though they will try to speak with it again if possible. When questioned about other SCPs, it showed fear and occasionally hatred, and refused to speak about any of them, even objects classified as safe. Additional: subject was found to be working for the clothing design company after an unusual number of homicides, suicides, and mental breakdowns of other models when working around SCP-056. When Class E personnel attempted to detain it, their mannerisms provoked it to change into what appeared to be the form of data expunged, resulting in the deaths of 17 agents and 10 civilians. The incident was covered up by claiming an employee suffering from psychopathy brought a firearm to work and attacked other workers. Addendum 1, Document 956-0, audio recording of first encounter with SCP-056. Begin tape. Agent, hey, listen up. Whatever you are, you're under arrest for murder. SCP-056. No, go away. Clicking noises. Agent has drawn his weapon. Agent, you need to come with us right now. SCP-056. You don't want to do that, you stupid little man. Expressions of surprise, presumably from onlookers. Agent, the f***? It looks just like data expunged. Gunshots and screaming. Tape ends. Addendum 2A. Document 956-1. Behavioral testing for SCP-056. Testing procedures. Data expunged. Addendum 2B. Results. One male Class D personnel, armed with knife. Intent to harm subject. Subject appeared as a lean, fit man of approximately 20 years of age. Subject proceeded to disarm and kill personnel. One female Class D personnel, bearing a bottle of fine wine. Intent to offer subject gift. Subject appeared as a beautiful woman, accepted the gift, and upon tasting, spit it back in the personnel's face before waving her away. Two Class D personnel, both male and female, carrying nothing and intending nothing. Subject appeared as a beautiful woman in a well-tailored business suit. Examined both personnel, then dismissed them. 10 Class D personnel, all male, intending and carrying nothing. Subject appeared as a beautiful woman, dressed in a low-cut red dress. After approximately 10 minutes, all personnel began showing signs of irritation, and 5 minutes later broke out in fighting. Subject waved them away after watching them for 7 minutes. One female level 4 personnel, voted to be best-looking woman on facility. Carried nothing, intended nothing. Subject appeared as an extremely aesthetically pleasing woman, and displayed a large lexicon and understanding of management skills. Spoke to personnel for nearly 90 minutes, until personnel became infuriated and left the room. Addendum 3. Note from Dr. Kenneth. I was recently informed that 056 has repeatedly requested access to the internet. When I asked 056 about this, it told me that we were unable to provide it with enough sycophants, and that it wanted the whole world to know its face. Needless to say, its request was denied. Item number, SCP-061. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. The source code for SCP-061 is to be kept on a standard archival quality read-only data compact disk, or CD-ROM. 4 copies of the CD-ROM with the source code are to be stored in separate maximum security inanimate object lockers. Except for purposes of approved experimentation, SCP-061 is not to be loaded, compiled, or run. Research proposals for SCP-061 require written approval from Site Command. Only one copy of the CD-ROM containing the source code for SCP-061 may be used at a time. The CD-ROM is to be returned to storage immediately after having been used to load the source code for SCP-061 to a device. SCP-061 must never be loaded, compiled, or run on any device which has a connection to the internet, either directly or via another device. SCP-061 must never be loaded, compiled, or run on any device which is physically capable of wireless connectivity, regardless of whether that connectivity is in use. For purposes of approved experimentation, SCP-061 may be loaded, compiled, and run on a LAN consisting of no more than 3 devices plus peripherals. No devices are to be disconnected from the LAN during experimentation. Following the conclusion of experimentation, all devices within this LAN are to be immediately reformatted. Audio output peripherals for this LAN are to be contained within an observation chamber, surrounded with noise-canceling vacuum insulation. In the event of a perimeter breach by hostiles during SCP-061 experimentation, all devices within the LAN are to be immediately destroyed. Description: SCP-061 is an acoustic computer program being developed by SCP researchers, with the intent of producing successful countermeasures to similar programs being developed by governments and individuals around the world. Inspired by research on data expunged, SCP Command saw both the potential and harm in the ability to control the brain functions of other human beings. Laymen understand that music can elicit certain emotions and memories, or various sounds can elicit fear and excitement by simply being heard. Governments around the world have been attempting to expand on that premise for decades. SCP research is the first to elicit responses on higher mental activities. Parts of the brain affected by SCP-061 differ from those stimulated by data expunged or by subliminal messaging. Instead of acting on parts of the brain that are thought to be in control of the subconscious, acoustic frequencies produced by SCP-061 intercept conscious thoughts as they are produced and replace them. Instead of a suggestion, the human hearing center bisects the conscious thinking mind of the frontal lobe with the motor control cortical homunculus of the brain. A baseline rhythm convinces the rest of the brain that the conscious mind is asleep and effectively stops conscious thought from continuing to the rest of the brain. In return, the frontal lobe experiences a pause that resembles the psychological effects of anesthesia. Acoustic codes developed by SCP-061 are interpreted by motor centers in the brain as conscious instructions, and the subject typically acts accordingly. Subjects will normally have a blank facial expression while under the influence of SCP-061. They are not responsive to attempts at conversation and express no desires, such as hunger or interest in sexual advances. Though all commands are followed without question, the effects of the auditory control cease once the subject is no longer able to hear the program. Most test subjects report being unable to remember the actions they performed while under control, but a few had experienced the effect of watching helplessly as their body acted against their will. The intent of such research is to discover ways to counteract the effects of auditory mind control. However, only two methods of countermeasures have proven successful as of yet. 1. The subject's hearing is impaired so that the individual can no longer hear the program, either by covering the ear or deafening the subject. 2. The program itself sends a coded instruction to the hearing center of the brain, permanently shutting it down. Though the ear continues to hear, there has been no progress in finding the proper code to reboot the hearing center of the brain. Addendum 01. All subjects are placed under auditory control, issued a coded auditory command, and then monitored. Subject 4402F. Command: sleep. Response: subject curled up into a fetal position on the floor, and her brain began emitting alpha waves associated with sleep. Her eyes remained wide open in the typical blank, empty expression associated with controlled subjects, but her eyes twitched rapidly in ways associated with REM sleep. Subject 4427M. Command: run on treadmill. Response: subject mounted treadmill and then proceeded to run. Subject did not turn on the treadmill, resulting in the subject impacting the control platform. Subject repeated this until the stop command was issued. Note: more detailed commands are advised for task-oriented commands. Subject 4427M. Command: turn treadmill on. Run on treadmill. Response: subject turned on the treadmill to maximum speed, mounted, and attempted to run before being ejected off the conveyor belt. Subject repeatedly attempted to turn on the treadmill to a random speed and run on it, with various outcomes. Note: more detailed commands are advised for task-oriented commands. Subject 4427M. Command: turn on treadmill to jogging speed. Jog on treadmill. Response: subject successfully jogged on treadmill until stop command was issued, which resulted in subject being ejected off the conveyor belt. Note: subject should be in a safe neutral position before stop commands are issued. Item number: SCP-072. Object class: safe. Special containment procedures: all known instances of SCP-072 are to be contained in a 3.5 meter by 4 meter holding cell. Access is allowed only during authorized testing procedures, without prior approval from Senior Researcher Grant. No materials created for the purpose of being slept on are to be introduced into a 15 meter vicinity of the holding cell. Description: instances of SCP-072 were first discovered in an apartment building in Michigan after two local media reports on SCP-072's effects caused a local panic, which drew the attention of Embedded Foundation Agent. SCP-072 is a shadowy and translucent projection which resembles a 0.9 meter long hand, the fingers of which taper to a sharp point. Detailed recording of SCP-072 is difficult, as it does not manifest at light levels above 5 lux. Instances of SCP-072 have only been observed to manifest when a human, hereafter referred to as the subject, enters REM sleep while located in a bed infected by SCP-072 and leaves a foot or feet exposed to open air. If these conditions are satisfied, SCP-072 will emerge from the foot of the bed and appear to use its pointer finger to tap on the subject's foot until they awaken. Subjects have reported that at this point, they were unable to move, showing symptoms similar to sleep paralysis. This continues as long as SCP-072 is visible. SCP-072 will then use its pointed fingers to cut portions of flesh from the exposed parts of the subject's foot or feet. It will return to within the bed in between each removal, emerging without the collected material. This will continue until SCP-072 has taken all of the exposed foot or feet, stopping at the ankle. Though subjects exposed to SCP-072 report this process to be immensely painful, its paralytic effects render them unable to scream or call for help. It is unknown if manifestations of SCP-072 feed on the collected material or use them for some other purpose. As long as the wounds are properly treated, SCP-072's effects are not fatal, but have been observed to cause psychological damage relating to sleep in the future. There is also a secondary effect. Any bed with an approximately 10-meter vicinity of a bed which manifests the effects of SCP-072 will also host an instance of SCP-072. Destruction of a bed affected by SCP-072 reveals no anomalous materials and no trace of biological material removed from subjects. Addendum: List of known SCP-072 objects. SCP-072-1-2-3, recovered from original apartment complex. Three twin-sized beds, which were located within 10 meters of one another. SCP-072-4, a king-sized four-poster bed, contaminated during SCP-072's time in Site's temporary anomalous objects holding. SCP-072-5, a sleeping bag with bottom removed, introduced to SCP-072-1 for testing. When D-2191 entered REM sleep in object, data expunged. SCP-072-5 not recommended for testing in future. SCP-072-6 and -7, beds introduced to SCP-072-2 and later destroyed for examination. Remains of SCP-072-6 and -7 appear unaffected, but are to be contained until further studies may be completed. Item number: SCP-078. Object class: Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-078 is to be left hanging on the wall of its containment cell and physically unplugged. The sole outlet in the room should be controlled by a switch, which must be left in the off position at all times, unless SCP-078 is undergoing testing. Personnel who enter the containment room should familiarize themselves with the position of the switch, so that they can locate it with their eyes closed in the event that SCP-078 is accidentally turned on. Description: SCP-078 is a pink neon sign, approximately 1.5 meters long, that displays the phrase, "Too late to die young." It was initially recovered in the town of after standard Foundation data mining protocols recorded an abnormally high death rate due to starvation or other forms of self-neglect. While powered off, SCP-078 has no abnormal properties and may be observed without effect. Viewing SCP-078 for less than 10 seconds while it is powered on has no effect, nor does indirect observation. Subjects who cannot understand SCP-078 due to a lack of ability to comprehend written English are also unaffected. However, any subject that views SCP-078 for longer than 10 seconds will, when viewing any handwritten piece of writing, occasionally perceive extra sentences. These sentences are not written in the subject's own style, or in that of the surrounding text, but consist of a random style that differs from note to note, and always are phrased as if to assuage the subject's guilt on some matter or decision they feel guilty about. For example, a D-class personnel who was convicted of murdering his wife in a heated argument read the sentence, "She deserved it for not doing what you said," in his handwritten journal, while Dr. who left his family to work for the Foundation and was accidentally exposed, found the sentence, "Your work will save humanity," in his notes on SCP. At first, the effect is beneficial, with affected subjects reporting greater peace of mind after exposure to SCP-078. However, the sentences shift from emphasizing the positive consequences of actions to de-emphasizing the negative ones on a time scale of 1 week. Dr. 2 days later found the sentence, "They never loved you anyway," in his personal journal. Moreover, the writing will start giving justifications for the acts the subject has never felt guilt over, which the subject has already rationalized. The subject will then start reconsidering his justifications for those actions, as well as attempting to justify any further actions that they take. The need for rationalization increases as time goes on, and they will start vocalizing their thought processes, and by the end of 1 week, any task the subject performs more trivial than the basics of survival will induce a bout of neurosis, as the subject attempts to rationalize why they did not instead take some other action. By the end of 2 weeks, the subject is unable to eat food. After the first bite, they will spend the next hour justifying why they ate that specific part of the meal first. Death due to malnutrition follows, unless the subject is fed intravenously. A number of D-Class personnel who have reached this stage, as well as numerous researchers who were accidentally exposed, are kept alive for purposes of study and to see if a cure can be found. The sole exception to SCP-078's effect is SCP-078 itself. Any subject who views SCP-078 a second time will see it displaying increasingly more guilt-inducing messages as duration since their first exposure increases. All subjects who have viewed it a week after initial exposure have attempted suicide. Addendum 078-1. D-19384, whose handwriting was an unusual mix of cursive and print, was exposed to SCP-078 and was then terminated after reaching the consequence-free stage. Subsequently, other subjects have reported seeing sentences in the same cursive print mix. It is possible that those who die after being exposed to SCP-078 are incorporated into it in some way. Item number, SCP-080. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-080 is to be contained in a 4-meter by 4-meter room, with a smaller antechamber located on the south wall to provide researchers with access. On the north wall, an observation room is to be connected, overlooking the main room through a window with thick blackout curtains that release only when the door to the observation room is closed. No attempts should be made to remove SCP-080 from this enclosure at any time. No more than one 7-watt incandescent light bulb is to be illuminated in the main room at any time. Absolutely no devices capable of producing light should be brought into the room. Under no circumstances should anything be brought into SCP-080's containment room that has the ability to shroud, conceal, or otherwise hide SCP-080. Failure to adhere to this will result in disciplinary action. Description: it is unknown if SCP-080 has a physical mass or body, as all attempts to interact with it physically have failed and have met with adverse effects. Researchers and personnel have described seeing SCP-080 as various shadows and humanoid effigies, with the only common attribute being two smoking eyes. It has come to the attention of researchers that SCP-080 induces uncontrollable drowsiness upon anyone entering its chamber. After approximately 30 minutes, any person observing it will be forced into REM sleep and may suffer irreversible psychological damage. This effect occurs even if SCP-080 is being observed from a separate room. If at any time SCP-080 finds a way to hide itself, such as in a cupboard, under a bed, covered in a sheet, etc., it will disappear entirely. Additionally, if any light enters SCP-080's containment room with a greater luminance than that produced by a standard children's nightlight, SCP-080 will instantly vanish. Both of these events are considered a containment breach, and any personnel responsible for this will be severely reprimanded and possibly reassigned. Experiment 080-2-A. Date, 2000. Subject, D-081. Male, 19 years old. Details: subject entered room containing SCP-080 at 1426. Begin log. Doctor, D-081, do you see anything? D-081. No. It's pitch black in here. Subject is silent for several minutes. D-081. Did you just let something in here? It feels like something's watching me. Doctor. No, D-081. We did not let anything into the room. D-081. What the fuck is that? D-081 is seen tripping and falling to the floor. Doctor. What do you see? D-081. This giant blackness, like someone just standing in the corner. Oh god, it's looking right at me. Let me out. D-081 proceeds to pound on the door leading into the antechamber. Doctor. It's looking at you. Please describe its physical appearance. D-081. I don't know. Oh god, let me out. I don't want to be in here. D-081 starts whimpering. Doctor. Tell me what it looks like, D-081. Then we can let you out. D-081. It looks like a figure, hunched in the corner. Doctor. Is it a human? D-081. It's too big to be human. D-081 yawns. It's still looking at me, Doc. Still staring. Doctor. Move closer to it. D-081 proceeds to move to the corner of the room, obviously experiencing difficulty staying on his feet. D-081. Its eyes look like vapor, just staring at me, like it wants me to do something. D-081 falls to the floor again. Doctor. D-081, can you hear me? Subject is unresponsive for the next 5 minutes. End log. Subject presumably collapsed. Subsequently, no remains of D-081 were found, and it is assumed SCP-080 consumed D-081. Experiment 080-2-B. Date, 2000. Subject, D-082, female, 30 years old. Procedure, subject was sent into room with SCP-080, with intent to physically interact with SCP-080. Details. Subject entered room containing SCP-080 at 1735, under instruction of Dr. Begin log. Doctor, tell me what you see. D-082. I don't see jack shit. Why is it so dark in here? After several minutes. Holy shit, what is that? It's just standing in the middle of the room. Doctor, describe what you see. D-082. It's just standing in the middle of the room. I can make out two eyes, I guess. Doctor, could you please approach it and let us know if anything changes? D-082. I feel drowsy. Did you slip me something or what? Doctor, reach out and touch it. Tell me what you feel. D-082. You want me to touch that thing? Doctor, yes. Please proceed. After a few minutes of argument, it is presumed that D-082 proceeds to touch SCP-080. At this time, the subject becomes unresponsive. End log. Subject was found asleep in the corner of SCP-080's containment room. Subject appeared to suffer no physical harm during experiment. Subject was interviewed after medical staff deemed D-082 to be in good physical health. Experiment 080-3-C. Date, 2000. Subject, D-083, male, 24 years old. Procedure. Subject was sent into room with SCP-080, having been given a powerful amphetamine. Upon entering the room, subject was advised to tell researchers what he saw. Subject describes a shadow-like figure in the center of the room. Subject was informed to stand still and inform researchers of any changes. 10 minutes into the experiment, subject began yawning and became noticeably frightened. Subject became uncooperative and attempted to escape the containment room. Upon failing to escape, subject announced an intent to harm SCP-080, and presumably attempted to attack it. Upon doing so, subject immediately collapsed. D-083's body was recovered from SCP-080's containment room soon afterwards, having apparently suffered a major heart attack. Upon collecting D-083's body, researchers described an intense feeling of unease, a feeling of being watched, as well as a more acute awareness of SCP-080's presence in the room. Interview log 080-1. Interviewed, D-082. Interviewer, Dr. Forward. D-082 was interviewed following an inconclusive experiment involving SCP-080, where the subject was secured in the room with SCP-080 for 37 minutes. Begin log. Doctor, please describe what you remember from the experiment. D-082. Doctor later notes that D-082 had a spaced out expression and tone of voice. You told me to walk over to it and touch it. I didn't want to. I didn't. Doctor, what happened when you touched it? D-082. When I touched it? Have you seen that thing? Touch it. I couldn't move. It was staring at me, and I just couldn't move. Doctor, you didn't respond for several minutes. What were you doing? D-082. Becoming increasingly agitated. It just stared at me. I couldn't move. I couldn't breathe. D-082 starts to hyperventilate. Doctor, calm down, D-082. Take a deep breath. Do you remember falling asleep? D-082. It just stared and stared, not moving, but I felt something. I was on the floor and they were all over me. They're here. D-082 begins to scream and abruptly gets to their feet. No, they're trying to take me away, back to that thing. I won't go back. You can't make me go back in there. D-082 lunges at Dr. is subsequently terminated. End log. Addendum 080A. On 2000, Dr. and his immediate staff have begun complaining of increasingly stressful dreams. As he has had the most interaction with SCP-080 thus far, it has been theorized that SCP-080 is somehow capable of some type of mimetic effect on nearby personnel, even if not being directly observed. Addendum 080B. Following Dr. R's recent suicide, all personnel located in SCP-080's sector are to keep dream journals, and are to inform site psychologists if dreams become increasingly violent or nightmarish in nature. Addendum 080C. All staff are reminded that the blackout curtains in the observation room will not release if the door is not closed, and that exposure time should not exceed 30 minutes for any reason. Addendum 080D. It has come to the attention of senior research staff that some researchers are unable to see SCP-080 and may be entirely immune to its effects. Any personnel that thinks they are incapable of perceiving SCP-080, please report for mandatory testing. Addendum 080E. It has been suggested following Incident 081 that a Class D personnel be fed to SCP-080 once per month in order to neutralize SCP-080's effect on the mental health of on-site personnel. 05 approved. Incident 081. On a planned observation was conducted by two senior researchers. The researchers entered the observation room, and the blackout curtains were released, believing the room to be safely shielded from SCP-080's effects, as it had in the past. The researchers began observing SCP-080. Approximately 40 minutes after observation began, both researchers suddenly fell asleep. Upon their retrieval, data expunged. It should be noted that following this incident, all on-site personnel that had reported suffering nightmares and feelings of unease had a good night's sleep, and were generally in a more pleasant mood the following day. Note: all personnel are requested to stop referring to SCP-080 as the Boogeyman. Dr. Item Number: SCP-081. Object Class: Euclid. Special Containment Procedures: only those with Level 4 clearance and written permission may have access to SCP-081. Full hazard gear, including suit, gloves, and an oxygen tank, must be worn at all times when in the containment area. Suits must be sprayed with a disinfectant shower before leaving the containment area. If containment is breached, the entire area must be exposed to ultraviolet light, and then bleached. Those who are suspected of being infected must be quarantined for at least 10 days. If no symptoms manifest after the 10th day, then quarantine can be lifted. Description: SCP-081 is a contagious virus that appears to be a mutated version of the virus, but with segments in its RNA instead of. The virus is human-specific, but is spread by rats who act as passive carriers. SCP-081 can also be spread through sexual intercourse and exposure to infected blood. SCP-081 infects adipocytes and leukocytes, inducing both to absorb nutrients at a vastly accelerated rate. As the nutrients are absorbed, infected B cells produce and secrete large quantities of a modified human antibody. adipocytes expand and proliferate, and the organism's caloric intake increases. When the concentration of adipose tissue reaches a critical point, the viral antibodies instigate systemic cell lysis, followed by an unknown process leading to the spontaneous combustion of the infected individual. There is a one-week incubation period before initial symptoms begin to occur. The duration of the symptoms depends entirely on the body fat percentage of the infected. Infection proceeds through four distinct stages. Stage 1. During the first week, there are no major symptoms, though subjects may report being slightly tired. Stage 2. In the second week of infection, subjects will begin to experience hot flashes and an increased appetite. Stage 3. Infected subjects demonstrate extreme polyphagia. They will do anything in their power to obtain food or anything edible. During this stage, metabolism slows down significantly, and weight gain proceeds rapidly. There is no set time that will elapse before the fourth and final stage. In order for the virus to complete its life cycle, the victim must be composed of 55% body fat. Stage 4. Once the subject reaches 55% body fat, the urge to eat will stop, though subjects report increased instances of hot flashes. Soon afterward, the body will go through an extremely violent version of widespread cell lysis. As cells burst, the modified antibodies catalyze the ignition of fatty compounds through unknown means. The body is incinerated from the inside out, via the wick effect, with the additional fat serving as a fuel source. Because stage 4 is largely asymptomatic, subjects are never aware when combustion will occur, and the exact timing is apparently random. Addendum 081-1. The first recorded incident of SCP-081 was reported in 1763 by Frenchman Jonas Dupont. In his book De Incendis Corporis Humani Spontaneis, he wrote about a case in Paris where a man was acquitted of killing his wife, as the jury agreed that the wife died due to spontaneous human combustion. It should be noted that the woman was incredibly overweight at the time of her death. It was not until the death of Mary Reeser on July 2, 1951, that SCP-081 was brought to the Foundation's attention. Despite the Foundation's best efforts, this information was leaked to the national media, along with pictures of the incident. It is believed that most reported cases of spontaneous human combustion are caused by SCP-081. Addendum 081-2. SCP-081 is estimated to have existed since the 10th century AD, and thought to have originated in... Because of widespread poverty and malnutrition present in many European countries at the time, instances of third and fourth stage infections were rare. North America has experienced the most cases of SCP-081 in the last century, but because of cleaner conditions and active rat population control, SCP-081 cases have dropped significantly. Fewer than people a year die from late-stage SCP-081. Addendum 081-3. Due to the United States' current obesity epidemic, it is crucial that wild SCP-081 be eradicated. The exposure that would result from a wide-scale epidemic would be disastrous to successful containment efforts. Dr. Addendum 081-4. During testing, it has been discovered that people who have diabetes have a natural immunity to SCP-081. This has not helped in the development of a treatment for the virus, and it remains incurable. Wild infections data expunged, and an alternate cause of death provided. Addendum 081-5. It was discovered that SCP-081 can spread by exposure to the ashes of a deceased victim. Containment and epidemic contingency protocols are being amended, and emergency services personnel who responded to Miss call have been detained for evaluation. Dr. Item number, SCP-088. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-088 is to remain sealed in its airtight case at all times. The case is constructed of transparent acrylic plastic to resist the corrosive properties of SCP-088 secretions. In the event that SCP-088 should awaken from hibernation, any room that it is stored within should be constructed of durable plastics, rubber, or ceramics to hinder its ability to escape. Temperature of SCP-088's containment should not exceed 15 degrees Celsius. and any personnel entering containment must observe Level 4 hazardous material protocols and wear the appropriate protective gear at all times. Any personnel who do not observe proper containment protocols in presence of SCP-088, or who show signs of physical mutation, are to be demoted to D-Class and held for observation. Description: SCP-088 is a humanoid with reptilian features, which appear to have been mummified in a languid posture. However, SCP-088 is merely in a state of hibernation, from which it may recover if it is again exposed to a more hospitable environment than its current containment. Research has indicated that SCP-088 is approximately 6,000 years old, and is capable of secreting a variety of hazardous biological compounds from its mouth and hands. Some of these substances could be of great strategic value if replicated, but until a means to extract them without awakening SCP-088 is found, research into this area is on hold. SCP-088 was recovered with the mummified remains of 23 beings, sharing a similar morphology. However, none of these beings were alive, and examination suggests that they were originally human. Information obtained by agents E-088-3 and E-088-7 and their subsequent mutation due to SCP-088 exposure corroborates this theory. Addendum: SCP-088 was recovered in 1931 from a subterranean complex below Los Angeles, California. The site was originally discovered by GWS using a device he called a radio X-ray, which was little more than a mechanical dowsing rod. While S's methods were dubious, his discovery was not. After mapping a series of tunnels and gold deposits below the city, S declared that he had found the lost city of the lizard people, as described in the legends of Arizona's Hopi tribe. S's claims went as far as to be featured on the front page of the Los Angeles Times on January 29, 1934, before the Foundation was able to verify his claims and silence Mr. S. The subterranean complex was not nearly as extensive as described in legend, and most of the artifacts recovered within were too corroded to provide significant information, save for a long message carved into the rock wall of an unfinished tunnel. Containment Breach Overview. In more than 70 years of containment, SCP-088 has only roused from its state of hibernation twice, breaching containment with a caustic fluid that dissolves most minerals and metals. Each time, multiple personnel were exposed to a second compound, which SCP-088 uses to propagate itself. Affected personnel underwent a painful mutation, after which they shared the physical characteristics of SCP-088. Those few who received a large dosage of the compound, administered directly via mouth-to-mouth contact, were changed the fastest, and subsequently sacrificed themselves to protect SCP-088 from harm. SCP-088 has also demonstrated the ability to produce potent neurotoxins in liquid and gaseous form to combat containment personnel. Containment during the second breach was re-achieved by isolating SCP-088 and affected personnel in the facility and lowering the temperature. Affected personnel built a pedestal from discarded equipment, upon which SCP-088 took a recumbent position before slipping back into hibernation. The mutated personnel were neutralized at this point, and SCP-088 was returned to containment. The current strategy of lower temperature and non-metallic containment has been successful in keeping SCP-088 isolated. SCP-088 was reclassified to safe status on November 19. Item number: SCP-091. Object class: safe. Special containment procedures: SCP-091 is to be stored in a standard containment locker at site. When SCP-091 is not being tested, it is to be placed under combination lock. Since SCP-091 has shown no signs of resistance to tearing or damage greater than that of normal cardboard, great care should be taken when transporting it to and from testing sites. During testing, no one other than the subject should view SCP-091. Those suspected of having seen SCP-091 are to be administered Class B amnestics immediately, and all personal recordings or images in the possession of the subject, both print and digital, are to be destroyed to prevent recurrence. Description: SCP-091 is a Scotty's brand tissue box, currently empty. Immediately upon observing SCP-091, viewers report an overwhelming sense of nostalgia. Those affected begin reminiscing about times they were near SCP-091, major events that occurred while it was present, or people and places that somehow relate to it. SCP-091 was originally recorded as an anomalous item and sent to Reliquary Site 44, until one of the members of the recovery team, assistant researcher, while viewing a recording of her wedding from 1990, noted SCP-091 in the background of the film and noted a strong flood of nostalgic memories attached to it, including memories of SCP-091 at the wedding itself, memories of SCP-091 at the reception, memories of SCP-091 during the honeymoon. A further interview with assistant researcher's ex-husband demonstrated that he too remembered SCP-091 in all those places and situations, again noting strong feelings of nostalgia and fondness for it. Further investigation found that several people who attended the wedding remember SCP-091 being there and the emotional effect. Others were asked to describe the wedding itself without being informed of SCP-091. In these cases, they described the scene without including SCP-091 until they were questioned about it directly. At that time, they immediately underwent the same previously observed effect. Continued testing under other situations has continued to produce similar results. Administration of amnestics has proven ineffective at stopping the effect if the subject is allowed to view an image or recording of SCP-091. Of note is the fact that in each recorded instance of SCP-091, the box pictured is full of tissues. Item number, SCP-097. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-097 is contained within the limits of the property where it was initially discovered, Zone SCP-097. The property is surrounded by an 8-meter-tall concrete block fence, fitted with barbed wire and security camera systems. Satellite images of Zone SCP-097 are to be doctored, removing all traces of the area. Any and all new plant growth outside the containment area suspected to originate from within the SCP is to be sterilized through application of boiling salt water and/or incinerated. Absolutely all abnormal behavior is to be reported to Dr. Bridge within 10 minutes of occurrence. If any personnel or their families experience hallucinations or thematically related dreams outside of containment, they are to contact Dr. Bridge to schedule treatment. Localities surrounding SCP-097, specifically, are to be monitored from the 1st of April until the 1st of November every year for affected civilians. Medical establishments dealing with sleep abnormalities are to be monitored for signs of SCP-097's influence. Civilians below the age of 16 encountered alone within 1 square kilometer of Zone SCP-097 are to be taken into Foundation custody and are to be treated with a Class B amnestic and returned home, or the nearest police station. Personnel tasked with the return of civilians are to avoid public exposure. Each agent is to be assigned a cover story to follow if they do encounter civilians en route to their destinations. The morning after the first frost of the year, a team of 25 agents armed with agricultural tools are to enter SCP-097 and clear away the outer plant matter. This process is not to continue past dusk. Description. SCP-097 is a 10-acre area of land in the state of in the Midwestern United States. It is the abandoned remains of the County Fair 1969, an area of approximately 2.3 kilometers squared, or approximately 5.4 square miles. Structures within the SCP area exist in a state of moderate disrepair, consistent with the expected age and environment. At the center of SCP-097 lie the remains of a 1956 GMC pickup truck, the majority of which is crushed beneath a colossal pumpkin of unknown subtype, henceforth SCP-097-1. SCP-097-1 stands approximately 7.4 meters or 24.3 feet tall, and 8.1 meters or 26.8 feet in diameter at its widest. Current estimates put SCP-097-1 at approximately 15,000 kilograms, or approximately 33,070 pounds. This pumpkin remains roughly spherical in shape, instead of spreading out under its own weight as would be expected of a plant of its size. The remaining portion of SCP-097, approximately 2 kilometers squared, is overgrown with several dozen varieties of pumpkins, with over 70 subspecies yet identified, and many previously unknown to agriculture. Many of these pumpkins have been shown capable of growing to enormous sizes, the average estimated weight being around 250 kilograms, average 550 pounds. These pumpkins, along with the other assorted crops, grow with, on, and around the remains of the 1969 fairgrounds, creating a maze-like arrangement of plant life. The average height of the walls within SCP-097 is 1.6 meters, though this may vary from year to year. Between April and November each year, the area within SCP-097 has produced a number of anomalous phenomena, ranging from benign to implicitly aggressive. To date, 17 agents have been severely maimed within SCP-097, 8 having died. Event Log SCP-097. This is a general incident log for SCP-097 for the cycle between September 1st and November 1st. This is an abridged version. Please requisition full individual reports from Dr. Bridge. During this time, 4 civilian children were captured and returned to their families. Event 1. Cameras 3B, 4A, 4C, 5B view child, approximately 4 years of age, walk between tangles of plant matter towards SCP-097-1 over an 8-minute period. Child appeared to be dragging a stuffed animal. Notes: child appeared on footage during review period. No figure was viewed at the time of recording. Event 2. Human scream heard from within SCP-097, heard throughout the site. On-site personnel described it as possessing a small child's voice, sustained for approximately 3 minutes before stopping abruptly. Notes: staff reported feeling as if they were being watched during the event. Event 3. Several bedsheet ghosts are seen throughout various security feeds throughout the day, would only appear for approximately 1 to 3 seconds before vanishing again. Staff did not report seeing any anomalous entities firsthand. Notes: patrols doubled for the remaining time in the SCP's cycle. Event 4. Unidentifiable singing is heard throughout the site, persisting for 3 hours before becoming silent. Recordings reveal song-like gibberish, with up to 30 individual children's voices singing at any time. Notes: recordings archived for future study. Event 5. Agent McRoy cuts a pumpkin's vine with machete. Severed vine proceeds to bleed approximately 50 liters of human blood before shriveling. Notes: blood type AB negative. No DNA match. Event 6. Overnight, 2 separate pumpkin patches grew into the rough approximations of human figures, lying on the ground. Notes: destroyed without incident. Event 7. Agent Long found decapitated, neck against a pumpkin. Notes: disappeared en route to a restroom break. Event 8. All light bulbs on site burn out within a 2-minute period. Notes: critical areas repaired before nightfall. Event 9. Sudden shift noted in the location of several dozen gourd plants. Notes: time and nature of actual event unknown. Event 10. Agent Cole accidentally damages and breaks pumpkin during weekly examination of SCP-097. Pumpkin splits open, revealing a complete human child's skeleton in the fetal position within. Notes: female approximately 5 years old. No DNA match. Event 11. 29 freshly decapitated crows, Corvus brachyrhynchos, found outside SCP-097's containment wall. Notes: none. Event 12. Matured pumpkin plant found to have replaced a potted plant growing inside Dr. Bridge's office. Notes: indoor plants banned from the site. Pumpkin incinerated immediately. Event 13. Agent Matthews falls unconscious during patrol and cannot be awoken until removed from property. Notes: agent reported dreaming of autumn colors and the smell of leaves. Full recovery. Reassigned to desk work pending examination. Event 14. Research assistant Sturm reports overwhelming taste and scent of pumpkin permeating her senses. No other personnel report anomaly. Notes: transferred off-site, examination pending. Event 15. Sounds of steady drums play throughout the day, from 00 to 23:59. Notes. Source of sound unknown. Recordings archived for future study. Event 16. Male child, approximately 6 years of age and clad in pajamas, seen climbing through corn stalks on the eastern end of SCP-097, moving towards SCP-097-1. Notes. Lost to SCP-097-1. How the child was able to escape notice by personnel until after he was lost to the SCP is unknown. Event 17. All personnel within 3.6 kilometers of SCP-097-1 report hallucinations of orange haze and children's laughter. Notes. Personnel evacuated to a distance outside the area of effect. Personnel screened for mental interference. Event 18. All power and backup power to the area failed. Upon recovery, a number of pumpkins within SCP-097 were found to have changed into carved lanterns. Notes. It is unknown how SCP-097 generated and lit candles. Team 097 Alpha and Beta tasked to destroy lanterns after sunrise. Event 19. Team 097 Alpha reports seeing and hearing children playing among the flora within SCP-097. Recordings lack the entities expected from the reports. Notes. Children noted to be clad in pajamas. Teams pulled from SCP. Screened for mental interference. Event 20. Zaya Maze and Dorada kernels fall from the sky around SCP-097. Does not fall within containment walls. Notes. Area cleansed with flame units and replanted with non-native grasses. Pavement of outside area pending. Event 21. Research assistant O'Toole overcome with nausea and vomits pumpkin seeds. O'Toole did not eat pumpkin seeds previous to vomiting. Notes. Research assistant O'Toole transferred to site for examination. Seeds incinerated with prejudice. Event 22. Research assistant O'Toole reported to have died overnight. Autopsy reveals thoracic cavity was filled with pumpkin seeds. Notes. Body incinerated at site. All personnel scheduled for full physical examination. Event 23. Unintelligible whispering gibberish heard by fertile female personnel throughout the area when in view of SCP-097. Phenomenon continues throughout the day, continuing for the duration of SCP-097's cycle, i.e., until November 1st. Notes. Associated personnel removed from duty and scheduled for examination. Event 24. Headlights of vehicle underneath SCP-097-1 light and stay lit until daybreak. Notes. None. Event 25. Fruit trees within SCP-097 blossom over the course of 5 hours, beginning at roughly 700 hours. Flowers wither and fall soon after. Notes. None. Event 26. Pumpkins near south entrance to SCP-097 began spontaneously bleeding from the stem. Each continued bleeding for 3 hours. Notes. Blood type AB negative. No DNA match. Event 27. Several dozen unidentified spheres of red light viewed drifting above SCP-097 and surrounding area. When light was shown directly on the spheres, a piercing shriek was heard. Notes. Personnel called into the main building until the spheres dissipated at dawn. Event 28. Sounds of steady drums are recorded from within SCP-097. Drums persist for the following 12 hours. Notes. No source identified. Recordings archived for future study. Event 29. All strawberry plants within SCP-097 wither in unison. Notes. None. Event 30. Between 25 and 30 animate human skeletons of varying size are recorded breaking out of larger pumpkins within SCP-097. Skeletons traverse through SCP-097's flora to the northeast peach tree and hang themselves from its branches using lengths of grapevine, electrical cable, and decaying rope. Skeletons ceased anomalous behavior after pantomiming death by hanging. Death throes continued for approximately 23 minutes. Notes. Skeletons recovered after first frost. All appeared under 12 years of age. No DNA matches. skeletons incinerated after examination. Addendum. Historical note. Prior to the construction of SCP-097's containment wall, instances of what are now known as SCP-21711 were occasionally observed to form fragmented walls, and at one point a near-complete ring of 2171 around SCP-097's area of effect. This behavior ceased following the containment wall's completion. The purpose and implications behind this interaction are as of yet unknown. Effects of SCP-097 on children. In addition to its immediate effects outlined in Event Log SCP-097, SCP-097-1 appears to produce an undetectable signal towards children in an undetermined range. For clarity, children will refer to individuals up to the age of 10. Beginning in early April, civilian children within SCP-097's undefined range may be overcome with somnambulism on clear nights. Affected children will move around their homes, stopping to face closed doorways for several seconds before moving on to the next nearest doorway, eventually returning to bed. At first, this behavior will occur only once a week, beginning with only the doors on a single floor. This sleepwalking will become more frequent, by mid-August happening every night. If forcibly awoken at any time during these episodes, they will scream for several seconds, before succumbing to a degree of confusion. After an affected child is awoken in this manner, the effect will cease, and the child will never show any further signs of SCP-097's influence. Over the course of 2 to 3 months, these episodes will become more thorough, affected individuals seeking out each doorway inside their home, as well as those on their household's property, such as garages, car doors, and fence gates. Eventually, they will begin visiting the front doors of neighbors. Beginning in September, affected children who have remained undisturbed during these episodes will begin to remain outside at sunrise, laying on grass near their homestead and returning to full REM sleep. Affected children may recall dreams centering around autumn activities. Between September 1st and November 1st, if the affected children have not been awoken during the preceding sleepwalking episodes, they will cease the previously established activity during the sleepwalk and instead begin to walk directly towards SCP-097's location. They will travel over fields and down secondary roads, steadily moving towards SCP-097. Local geography consists mostly of undeveloped Foundation-owned property, facilitating uninterrupted travel. Upon arrival at SCP-097, an affected child will sit down before SCP-097-1 and begin singing unidentifiable gibberish as music begins to play. While a number of instruments have been recorded, simple drums and pipes are the most consistently encountered. After several minutes, childlike entities will crawl out from tangled flora, or break out of larger pumpkins within SCP-097. The children will be wearing whatever they were last seen with, most often pajamas or similar clothing. Many of these entities match those children known to be lost to SCP-097-1. The entities will surround the affected civilian child, dancing and singing in a circle, as SCP-097-1 begins to emit dim light. The affected child will awaken, normally expressing a great deal of terror. The instant any vocalization is produced, the entities will swarm and kill the child. Methods used are different in each instance, but usually involve dismemberment or strangulation. At this point, any and all efforts to interrupt the entities will fail, whether through breakdown of equipment, sudden intangibility of the subjects, or express violence on the part of SCP-097. After the death of the affected child, SCP-097-1 will split open, and the entities will hurl the remains into it, before climbing in themselves. SCP-097-1 will then close, and the music will stop. Before the containment wall was erected, at least children between the ages of 3 and 10 are known to have been lost to SCP-097. Item Number SCP-099. Object Class Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-099 is kept in a 1 meter by 75 centimeter wall-mounted fireproof case in Gallery 27. Standard climate and humidity controls apply to this section of the gallery. Due to its properties, SCP-099 can only be viewed within the gallery by level 2 staff or higher, and only from a distance greater than 5 meters, and for a period not to exceed 5 minutes per day. When not being viewed, the case is to remain shut and electronically sealed. Description: SCP-099 is a 73 by 50 centimeter painting titled The Portrait. Created in 1935 by surrealist painter René Magritte, the original painting possesses mimetic properties that trigger acute paranoia and lingering psychological effects when viewed for too long or from a distance of approximately 3 meters or less. The painting depicts a simple still life, with the addition of a single eye staring back at the viewer. A reproduction of the work currently hangs in the Museum of Modern Art in New York, with critical elements removed to prevent the paranoia trigger. Detailed reproductions and photographs of the original work retain its mimetic properties. Those who have viewed the painting for too long, or from too close of a distance, become subject to the delusion that any being or depiction of a being with eyes is staring at them. In extreme cases, subjects report that inanimate objects are making eye contact. The condition is so severe that subjects will even report making eye contact with individuals whose heads are completely turned away. Depending on the length of the original exposure to the painting, subjects may suffer from this condition until death, resulting in severe paranoia and anoclophobia. Addendum: SCP-099 was recovered from the private collection of K. Sage, another surrealist painter. Recovery was performed by MTF Theta 6, Pink Panther. Mrs. Sage was unaware of the recovery and replacement of SCP-099, although pre-recovery investigation suggests she was aware of its properties and was either immune or careful not to look too closely. Magritte was still alive at the time SCP-099 was stored in Gallery 27. He remained under Foundation surveillance until his death in 1967. Research suggests that the painting's mimetic trigger was intentionally created, although the effect and power of the trigger was likely unintentional. The Foundation has studied the rest of Magritte's work and found no anomalous mimetic properties to this date. Weaponized replication. Data expunged. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.